Selectmen to order. I'd like to briefly review tonight's agenda. First item will be our usual reports and comments, including Selectmen's liaison reports and comments, public comment, and the town manager's report.
Hi, John.
Hi.
We're just going to plug you in here.
Okay. Do you guys see TV not broadcasting?
We're just calling the meeting to order, so I suspect they'll start.
Okay.
Getting our fifth member here. He is participating remotely. Good evening, John.
He's got to turn the sound down.
Caller, would you mute your phone, please?
Caller, mute your phone.
Hey, John, could you just turn your sound down in the back? I feel like I'm talking to Eddie Amble.
Okay, following reports and comments, at 7:20, we will be discussing plans for Reading's 375th celebration. It's a good event coming up in not too distant future. At 7:30, we will talk about changing over our voting machines and approving new voting machines. Is that supposed to be voting? It says noting.
Voting.
Voting.
Sorry.
At 7:40, we will discuss moving the local election to coincide with the state presidential, that should be the federal presidential primary on March 1st, 2016. State primary is later in the year. Then we have two public hearings, one at 7:55, which is an early opening request for Tread LLC at 6 Linden Street to open at 5 a.m. and at 8 p.m. approximately. A hearing on private road acceptances for Causeway Road, Corey Lane, Dividence Road, Tonview, Roma Lane, and Sailor Tom's Way. At 9 o'clock, we will then close the warrant for the November town meeting, and we also have approval of minutes from our September 1st, 2015. No executive session tonight, Bob?
No.
Okay. All right, let's begin with Selectmen's liaison reports and comments. Why don't we start this way this time? John?
Thank you, Dan. A couple of things. I wanted to take note of last Wednesday's returning of Army Sergeant Christopher Vars, 65 years after being listed as an MIA, one of literally thousands of missing in action from a variety of other conflicts abroad. And it's thanks to the tireless effort of both the armed services and the civilian groups that are focused on missing in action soldiers returning their remains home and giving some comfort to their families and the descendants of families to know what happened to their loved one. These men do a tremendous service for our country, in this case, two generations or more ago, and we should all be proud for Sergeant Vars and those like him who made the ultimate commitment to their country. And it's the least we can do to recognize his return finally to his home nation. Secondly, on a much more ordinary note, I did participate in the, I guess it's twice annual, hazardous waste cleanup, and it's done in Wakefield, a cooperative effort between Reading and Wakefield. And I have to say, Bob, just how well run it is. It opened at 8:30, and I got there at 7:30, and I was already the fifth in line. So, and in an hour, I couldn't see the end of the traffic. It's very well run, very clean, and it's a great way to dispose of the variety of things you accumulate over time, and you simply don't want to throw in the garbage. That's it. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Barry.
A couple of things. On the first, Chairman Ensminger and myself attended the a meeting of the Climate Advisory Board. They, if you recall, were interested in having the board support legislation to fix gas leaks, of which Reading had reported 140-150 leaks. You recall also at the time the board decided to take no action on that, so they requested us to go, and we talked about sort of the process and what came to that decision. But also, more importantly, we talked to them about their plans for the future. And they have some really exciting things planned afoot that I think it would really kind of marry some of the things that we've talked about on the board. One of the things that they're, in particular, that they're going to focus on is assisting seniors in town with accessing energy audits, and then also getting some weatherization materials that can help them save significantly on their heating bills, so that they would work with other groups in the town to do that. And so that was one plan that they were talking about, and of course, pursuing some of the solar initiatives that they had brought before the board before. And Dan, you might want to add something to that.
No, I think you covered it well.
And then I attended the building committee for the library. Drive down Middlesex if you haven't. Every day it looks like there's another little piece going on. It looks really exciting. You know, there were some as there always are in projects like this, things that weren't you couldn't really anticipate. Big part was sort of the drainage in the back, which took up a lot of time, energy, and a little bit of the contingency. But it looks like from the report of the project manager that, you know, some of the major, well, most of the major things that could go wrong have already happened, so that they don't really anticipate anything major happening. They'll probably use most of the contingency. You know, it'll be tight toward the end, but they're making progress. Looks like it's pushed back a little bit, I think a couple of months on the opening, but, you know, at this point, no huge cause of concern in terms of, you know, cost overruns or things that we need to be worried about.
Thank you. Kevin.
Thanks, Chairman. I spoke with the chair of the Human Relations Advisory Committee on a couple of different occasions. If you recall, we just recently re-upped them again. They were due to sunset this past June. And their direction of where they're going, they're kind of trying to figure out who they are and what they want to be, and also try to see with from a town government standpoint how that meshes with them being an advisory board to the Board of Selectmen. So they're trying to kind of figure that out as of right now. So with a few conversations that I've had with the chair, I think it's something that we should have put on our agenda for a future meeting to bring before the board, and, you know, maybe have a bigger discussion with some other folks involved in the discussion as well. A lot of their problems that they've been having has been around trying to promptly get out a press release if an event occurs that they feel they need to. And it's something that I think from a standpoint of being an entity of town government, it's a tough thing for them to kind of figure out. So I think they need a little more direction from us as far as what exactly we're looking for them being an advisory board. And also a little bit more clarification on what, you know, with that direction, what you can do with it. So, I don't want to take up too much time. I know we're already running a little bit behind, but I think certainly we can have a broader discussion at another night in regards to it.
Thank you very much. John Alty, hearing us okay? Still with us, John?
Yeah.
Okay.
Are you? Wait,
okay. Would you like to give any kind of a liaison report, or you want to pass?
I think that, Dan, everything I've done, I've kind of done with you.
Yep.
Since the last meeting, so I'm going to defer to you.
All right, thank you. All right, I just wanted to announce two upcoming items under my report. We still have the financial forum on for tomorrow night, Bob?
Correct.
That's at 7:30 at the
Coolidge.
Where?
Coolidge.
That's a Coolidge. Oh, thank you.
It'll be a Coolidge, the main meeting room way in the back. Okay. And another item, this is wide community interest. We will finally be interviewing, this is the permanent building committee interviews. The interview committee consisting of myself, the moderator, and the chair of the school committee will be meeting next Wednesday, September 23rd, in the town hall conference room, I believe, at 7 p.m. to make those appointments, do those interviews and make those appointments. So just call that to your attention. I think Barry covered our meeting with the climate committee quite well. Okay, with that, is there anyone here?
There
we go. Turn your radio down.
Got to mute him.
Now he's gonna
okay.
Talk.
Do we have any public comment for any item that is not otherwise on the agenda, Mr. Brown?
Let me tell him.
Yes.
Bill Brown, 28 Mark Road. Several weeks ago, you gentlemen were found to be ADA compliant through the 25th anniversary of that. And I find it kind of funny that since that time, this town hall has made no progress to completely get in. A handicapped person in a wheelchair cannot get in that back door. In one room of the building, there is no bathroom shelter. As you know, I've been watching the climbing wall at the Birch Meadow School. I'm told that it's in progress, and John Cudo knows that. And I was up to the Killam a couple weeks back. That playground is not accessible. So I think, you know, we've got a very poor record of accessibility. I find it quite, I don't really want to say, that we're accepting awards for compliance with ADA and whatnot.
Bob, do you have any comments on the town hall?
The only comment on the playgrounds was that the Wood End Playground is the only one that's officially designated as fully handicapped accessible.
But they've all been built within the last 25 years, and they should have been all ADA compliant.
Well, that's, I guess, a community discussion and decision. The Wood End Playground is substantially more expensive for that reason.
Well, John Feudal gave me the excuse that the climbing wall at Birch Meadow School, they ran out of money. I said, well, you shouldn't have started the project then. And I've actually threatened them that if it isn't compliant, it will be calling the state.
I'm really not familiar with the wall, but I do know, for instance, for the Wood End Playground, to be fully handicapped accessible takes quite a lot of space.
Oh, I know. I'm well aware of that.
Bob, do you have any comment on the town hall part of it?
It's certainly not handicapped accessible to modern building codes by any stretch, but every time we do a repair, we improve it. Down at community services at the end of the hall where the building inspector is, there's now a low counter with someone in a wheelchair could actually have access to. So you can get to every place in the building, but I'll agree with Bill that it's far from ideal.
I don't think we have a handicapped stall on the second floor, is that correct?
That's correct.
Is there anything being done about that?
No, there's no room.
No room?
But the bathrooms are too small.
Okay.
I have no problem with that, but I think in the future we should, on these projects that we do, they should be handicapped accessible. And as you all, some of you know, I have a personal interest in it.
Thank you, sir. Any other public comment? Okay, hearing none, we will move on to the town manager's report.
Thanks. Just two things. One is on the website, you'll see under town news right here, senior services survey. I would encourage everyone in the community to go and fill that out. There's a link right at the bottom here or in the middle. And we're very interested in what the community values for services to 55 and older. So help in filling out that survey would be great.
We're looking for inputs for those 55 and those under 55.
Actually, the inputs can be from anyone. When I first read the survey, it seemed to ask older people, but it didn't mean to. So really anyone.
Right. That was confusing.
Eligible. When you get to the survey itself, there's a line in there right here. Meet the needs of residents 60 and over. Anyone can answer the survey.
Yeah. And part of it was a little confusing because it would say, like, what do you use?
True.
And, you know, I can anticipate using some of those services in a few years, but I don't use them now. But that shouldn't mean that I don't think that they're valuable. So there's a little, the way it was constructed was a little confusing, and I just...
Part of it is a desire to get at the current usage, mm-hmm. and then part of it is looking forward. Right. So you're right. The only other thing that's, I won't go into detail, but in your packet tonight is a preview of tomorrow night for the financial forum, just for your knowledge. That's all I have.
Thanks, Bob. Okay, 7:20 has come. Do we have the folks here that are supposed to be here for the 375th? Yeah?
Yes.
You raise your hands. Okay, are you expecting Alan to come in, or?
Alan is sick.
Oh, I'm sorry about that. Why don't you come on down and you can speak from there too. The mic will pick you up, but you're welcome to come up front too. Okay, and could you guys, folks, I know you are, but could you introduce yourself for our viewing audience?
I'm Ace Bowles.
I'm Phil Rushman.
Yep.
Alan would really much rather be here than
no doubt.
He's feeling at home right now, but I'm sure he's watching.
Yep.
So I hope I can speak as well as he is. So I'll use his notes. But we are a group of Reading residents who think it's time to start thinking about planning the town's 375th. And the reason we're involved is that we were also involved in the town's 350th, and that was in 1994. We were Dan, of course, a member of the Board of Selectmen at the time. Chairman, no, member.
I was here then.
And anyone else who was here at the time, surely remember. It was a great time. We had 13 days of celebrating. We had events. We had a massive parade. We had a grand ball that had 1,100 guests. We had a full day of picnicking and fireworks at the very end. And in the middle, we had a first night-like event that had activity going on in almost all the buildings in town. That group actually started in 1989, the formation of that group started in 1989. So we grew up on schedule. And they got together and they decided a party should be held. And they came to the Board of Selectmen and asked for a committee to be formed. Town meeting actually created a 9-person board. 3 members were appointed by the Board of Selectmen, 3 by the town moderator, 1 each by the Historical Commission, the School Committee, and the Antiquarian Society. Alan was elected chairman of that committee. One of the legacies of that, of the 350th celebration, was to put aside $10,000 for the town to use for seed money to celebrate the end of the millennium. And we did that, and forming another committee, and we had a 24-hour party starting at 5 a.m. on December 31st, ending 5 a.m. the following day. We had a huge white tent on the common, heated tent, had activity, had bands and performances in there all night long, as well as in all of the buildings around, entertaining all of the buildings around the square, each having a decade for being entertainment. And I was the chairman of that. But this time around, we thought we put together an exploratory committee whose main purpose is to propose a steering committee to direct the 375th observance. And right now, it consists of myself, Alan, Phil, Stephen, Kathy Crook, Katie Robertson, and Amanda Folds. Does anybody up? And so we come to you now, and thank you very much for putting us on the schedule, but we come to you now and figure out just how, what kind of a committee and how we see forming the next step. And Phil has some ideas on that.
So I think in your packets tonight you have some information that we at the brainstorming committee thought might be a way to proceed. One option would be for the Board of Selectmen to designate us as a committee to start running a 375th committee celebration. Another would be to have us get onto the warrant for probably the upcoming town meeting, if that's possible, to have town meeting put it out there. Or the board could designate a group itself, I believe, under the charter, I think. So there's sort of 3 options. We didn't want to get too much into some of the ideas that we were thinking about having, because we don't have that power yet. We're going to get going with that once a group is formed. But we think there should be some of the events that were done before for the 350th should be repeated, and we're anxious to get going on planning, because even though it's 3 years away, that's not a lot of time.
No. So do you folks have a preference about how you'd like the committee structured? Did you say last time town meeting appointed it?
Town meeting appointed a committee.
Town meeting appointed the process.
Well, they actually approved
right?
a committee, yeah. And the members were selected by different groups, the selectmen, by the town moderator.
We are right at the point tonight of closing the warrant for the subsequent town meeting in November. So the next opportunity, barring a special town meeting, would be annual town meeting in 2016. Is that, if we do it that through town meeting, is that sufficient time to, or would you prefer some other action, maybe by the board earlier, if that's not good enough?
If that's the way it needs to be, I think we can, you know, we would be able to work with that.
That would work out. Okay. Yeah, John.
Just a thought is, as you think back to 1644 and 1620 before it.
I wasn't here then.
Prove it.
He wasn't.
You were.
What was originally the town of Reading, the kind of epicenter, was actually present in the town of Wakefield. And this was kind of the hinterlands of the town. This may be a silly thought, but is there any thought about kind of coordinating, at least linking with the, I'm guessing, the all three towns, North Reading, Wakefield, and Reading, all claim 1644 is kind of one of their genesis dates. Any thoughts about linking the activities, even if it's just informational?
Yeah, it's something we would be willing to talk to them about.
It's a big deal, right? This is one of the oldest communities in the New World, right?
Yeah.
What do you think of it? Okay, Gary.
When you did this for the 350th, did the town set aside any kind of a budget, or was it all?
No, it was all done by fundraising. And that's the way that, you know, we will proceed until until a group becomes a 501c3, they can't really fundraise. But you know, that's the plan, is to get incorporated so that we can have fundraising to pay for some of these events, as well as apply for money through the Celebration Trust, some of the money left over from the 350th. But a large chunk of that money was set aside for the 400th, so, you know, it's there for the really big party.
And actually, all of the members who are on this exploratory committee are also involved in either the 350th or the Millennium Party, and most of us were involved in both. Phil was just a little kid, but his coverage of the events was unbelievable.
Funny story about the 350th. My wife and I were in the convertible riding down the street. I think it was here at the time. And I was waiting for some waves, and you're all saying, "Hi, Mrs. Ensminger. Hi, Mrs. Ensminger." She's a teaching aide, of course, and she gets all the attention. So what am I, right? But I need a lesson in humility, I think, back to that. That was a great time. We'll take this up certainly at a subsequent date for more thorough discussion. My out-of-the-box thinking is it's probably wise to go back to town meeting and have them constitute this committee again. And we have some time to work with you in the meantime to craft a warrant article. So why don't we plan on doing that in the coming months? Wish you well. I'm looking forward to everything that's going to happen. You only have 3 years, not 5 years.
I know.
So I'm mindful of that. That's why I asked the question.
But it won't be as big a scale as the 350th anyway, because it's called a business.
Sure.
We'll save that for the fourth time.
Sure.
I wasn't in town at that time. What time of the year was it? Was it a summertime, springtime, fall time?
End of May into June.
Funny thing is, the town of Reading's, if you go back to the original really wasn't an incorporation, but in incorporation, there were two. The town was, the name was voted on May 29th in one house, and it happened to be the day that the legislative body split to two houses. So the second vote was taken on June 10th. So we took May 29th is the start, and June 10th is the finish. And that's how we did it.
It's perfect weather.
Perfect weather.
Okay. Thanks for bringing it to our attention.
Okay. Thanks very much. Right.
We
have more
tend to look at like none of you.
Yeah. Day by day. So what would you need from us?
Going forward, you folks having regular meetings?
Yeah.
Just keep in touch. You can certainly email me and Bob, and we will keep the board apprised of your progress. If there's another opportunity where we should get together and discuss a warrant article, we'll do that. We're just looking at some of the accelerated dates. It looks like the warrant is going to close fairly early if we move the election. So we'll have to have that together by January 26th. So keep that date in mind. Yeah,
I think just one more thing. So you folks are going to be kind of meeting sort of ad hoc. One thing that I would encourage you to do, and while it's great that you're still here and did all that work on the 350th and volunteering to try to make some effort to sort of outreach to maybe folks who weren't here at the 350th.
That's why we're here.
And to just kind of gain some excitement and interest of folks who are new, who will bring a different spin to it, who will have different thoughts and ideas. So I would just encourage you to kind of.
We didn't want to make any public announcement until we got approval from the board. You know, we have a Facebook page, we have an email address, all that stuff ready to go.
So if someone would like to look for more information on the 375th or sign up to help, what would you tell them to do?
They can contact any of the committee members. I work at RCTV. They can contact me there. You know, Alan is at town meeting usually. You can run into him. All of us are here. Steve's always at the selectmen's meeting, so you can run into him.
You want to give out your Facebook site just so the folks know? Can they get that information there?
I actually don't know it yet. do you know what it is?
Red 375, isn't it?
I think it is.
Yes.
Bob, is it possible if you post a link up on the town website?
Yes.
Great.
We'll
send you all the information.
So look on the town website for the 375th if you're interested.
Thank you very much. Someone else have a next one? Next one was talking about the old and the new in terms of voting machines. We have an update on that.
Okay.
Laura will explain. We're not going to do the out with the old and with the new, but we are going to discuss moving the election.
Okay.
And Laura can fill you in.
Okay. So we're not going to cover that item tonight. All right. The show, it's all yours.
Hi, Laura.
Hi.
Good evening.
How you doing?
We're just grand.
So we, as you know, did the demonstration of both machines, and I let you guys know the date we did that, August 5th. And after the demonstration of the machines, there was a little bit of a kind of like, you know, everybody, it was mixed between which machine. We put out the RFP. The RFP was due today at 3 o'clock. We opened up, and I was hoping at 3 o'clock something would stand out in one of those responses so that I can come to you tonight. But we're still, it was pretty much the cost is the same. So what I would like to do is take the time to read through the responses and make sure that we make the right decision.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm requesting that we come back in at your next meeting in October.
Okay.
And at that point, we'll have a definite decision. I want to make sure that this machine lasts another 20 years. So, you know, we just like to take the time to read through the responses. Nothing stood out. Everything, you know, I'm dealing with both machines are great. Both will do well with Reading. Both companies will do well for Reading. The cost is within $100 of each of the machines. So there's nothing that stands out to make it a quick, easy decision. The election workers did the demo, and it's kind of still a mix as to which machine we should go with. So,
okay. Is that what you're referring to when you say the results? The questionnaire is coming back. The election workers.
When we did the demo, we had about 20 election workers here, as well as three or four other clerks from other communities. You know, because I wanted to get input from everybody,
right?
Including experienced clerks that have done this. You know. Lot longer than I have, and we also had four or five different town employees that was involved in also in the demo. It's a tough decision, and we want to make sure we do the right thing. So,
okay.
I would like to request to spend a little bit more time reading through the responses from them.
That's fine. You want to just talk about the movement of the town election and the.
Couple questions. Did any of the other communities, are they also contemplating the replacement of their voting?
Yes.
Does any of this get more interesting for the companies if there's some larger deal that can be constructed among the towns?
I actually asked that question.
Well.
In a couple of other communities that were here and I actually sat down and, you know, talked a little bit about it, and in order for that to happen, we would have had to agree on which machine. Neither one of us know which one we want to go with.
Well, you could do it two ways. You could do a contingent based on agreement at a later date.
Right.
They price it both ways, but it might shake it up a bit. The other thing is, did you include 20-year maintenance or 10-year maintenance in the proposal? Is there a maintenance element to these machines,
yes,
or you buy them once and they work until they die?
The maintenance element was included, but not for 10 or 20 years. It's because the state only requires them to do it for seven.
So a lot of times in capital equipment, the maintenance gets discounted tremendously. So another way to maybe get more for your money is asking for a 10-year or 20-year maintenance commitment as a separate line item on the quote, and see what they quote for the out years, because it may be that they give you that. At that point, you're either going to throw it away because it's technologically obsolete, so they tend to discount it, but it's an opportunity to get more for not much more. A couple of thoughts.
Yes, Bob.
Those are good ideas. Unfortunately, in public procurement, you can rarely go past 3 years unless you get a town meeting vote for any contracts.
Even for like the 7-year maintenance? Pennywise and pound foolish.
So you can't know what the deal is to show town meeting.
You can't get there from
there. To get permission to do it.
Is that all 30B stuff? Or is it something else?
I'm not sure. I don't want to say it.
Are there any other restrictions on the multi-town conversation?
No, vendors are obviously very reluctant to have that discussion. We've had it in the technology space many times, and it does seem like a no-brainer. You know, you list all the products we have, and so does our neighbors. Mm-hmm. We're all paying full boat. It's tough.
I did have the conversation with both vendors as to whether or not it would make a difference in the price, and they both said no.
Yeah, they always say no.
Does anyone do, another silly idea, does anyone do rental? This may sound crazy, but if it's in your middle of a technological shift, can you get the things for 1 year for 10% rate and, you know, defer the decision so you're not in?
I've never heard of that.
As far as election machines, I've never heard of that being a possibility.
All,
but
it happens in larger machines.
Yeah.
Yes, Rick.
When you did the RFP, did you ask the vendors to list the names of the towns who they sold machines to?
Yes.
And then you can do due diligence and see if whether or not the towns are happy with those. So have you done that, or is that part of your process to want to come back and interview, you know, talk to them?
I've talked to quite a few other communities and what they're happy with, and I've actually had a very candid conversation with the State Elections Division, and I came right out with the question of, if you were making this decision, which would you prefer us to purchase? I didn't get a direct answer. I did get an indirect answer. But again, you know, both, you know, machines, you know, there's no answer to that question. You know, they're both certified by the state. They're both acceptable by the state. Both companies have been under contract by the state to provide service for 7 years.
And towns are happy?
Yes. All the way around.
So if you delay it for another month, if we move our election up, is that enough time to get them installed and programmed and trained?
I have to notify the state by November 1st, absolutely no later than November 1st, mm-hmm. that we've purchased these machines. So the vote has to come from you guys by mid-October. So we don't want to delay it another 30 days. I will be here on October 6th with a decision,
okay.
One way or another.
And you're confident you have enough time to get everything set by
yes.
March 1st if we do that. Okay.
Yep.
Okay.
All right, so on to the next topic. For the last, I think, two presidential primaries, we have combined the town election with the presidential primary. Laura, from all observations on my part, that's worked out pretty well. We've saved money in terms of, we save some money. We, you know, have a single election day. One, we save money on police detail, not necessarily on the election workers, but there are savings there. Is there any downside we should be aware of? I guess I would say the new machines could be a downside, but you just said that should not be a problem.
No, it will not be a problem.
Okay. Anything else you could think of to not do it?
On a downside,
yeah.
No.
Okay.
It doesn't save as much money as you would think, but it does save the town some money, and
yeah.
And it helps bring a higher turnout for the local election, which I think is important.
Yeah, that's true. And most who take ballots for one take ballots. There's two different ballots. I noticed that. Yeah.
In the past, if you look at the numbers, there's maybe 10 people out of every, you know,
yeah.
There's one or two along the way that refuse one of the ballots.
Right.
And it comes out as a wash because some refuse the local and some
yeah.
refuse the primary. So
they'd rather vote for someone than the president, huh?
I don't know how we remedy this, but I think I was actually an election worker back in 2008, and we saw cases where people were voting for what they thought were town meeting members on the town committee slots on the presidential ballot and vice versa. Is there anything you can think of to maybe have an educational campaign? Hey, make sure you put your town meeting people on. I don't know how much you can say about that.
Yeah, well, that necessarily won't be a problem here because it's a presidential primary, so there's not going to be any town committee on the ballot.
There are? Oh, yes, there are. That's
yeah,
when they're
there
elected.
Is.
That's when they're
I take
elected.
That back. Education. I mean, I can start doing some shout-outs and
some
press releases and work with Matt to get it out there.
That it
could be an issue. On the downside, it's going to be a little bit longer day for the election workers because
I remember that.
Of having to do the, there'll be a lot of write-ins on both ballots.
Right. I reviewed, Laura published an election and town meeting calendar for the next several years, and I took out the calendar for 2016 and reviewed it with her. If we move the election from April 5th, as originally scheduled, the town election, back to March 1st, it's essentially a five-week shift on all the key dates. So there'd be a five-week shift on the closing of the warrant, which originally would have closed on March 1st for the April 5th election, as it was originally scheduled. Now the warrant, if we move that election to March 1st, will close January 26th. So there will be an impact on getting those articles ready. The budget discussions probably can proceed independent of that because the verbiage in the warrant isn't driven by that. So warrant would close on the 26th. I'm showing nomination papers due by January 12th instead of February 16th. And voter registration closing on February 10th as opposed to March 16th, including change of party designation. And I just reviewed those with Laura. She said they were good. So we will have a common warrant closing date for both the town election and the annual town meeting on January 26th.
Typically,
yes.
Real quick, Laura, I'm assuming, obviously, that since we're moving everything up, you're going to move everything up on the other side, too, as far as getting out letters to town meeting members that their terms expire and they're coming up, all that, so they're aware of when they can pull in, when they have to file by.
Right.
Okay.
Yep. There was a question Bob was just asking, and Dan and I talked about. Nomination papers will be due in January 12th. Typically, with them being due in February, I make them available in December.
Right. Mm-hmm.
So in this case, I'll make them available in October.
Okay. But you'll send out letters to the folks that early, too, that are going to be coming up for election.
Right.
Right. Okay.
The letters will go out first week of October around that vicinity.
Great.
And then papers will be available mid-October, end of October.
Perfect.
Yep.
Okay. Any other questions from the board regarding either the voting machines or the moving of the election?
No.
If do we have a motion, please? 5C.
I'm sorry,
Bob.
Yes. Vote if John Halsey's still here, you want to do a roll call.
Oh, yes.
Oh, that's right.
Okay.
Yep.
You have the volume up on that?
If he's still there.
Listen, John, you still there? We're ready to vote on the moving of the election.
See if he wants anything to say.
Do you have any comments?
I'm still there.
Okay.
I'm still there.
Okay.
Can you hear me?
Yep. We're about to take a vote on moving the election. Can we have a motion, Kevin?
Move that the Board of Selectmen approve moving the local election to March 1st, 2016 to combine with the, it's supposed to be federal presidential primary?
Should be federal presidential primary. Okay, is there a second? Mr. Berman seconds. We'll have a roll call vote in accordance with our remote participation policy. John Halsey, how do you vote?
Yes.
Barry?
Yes.
Kevin?
Yes.
John?
Yes.
Marina?
Yes.
I vote yes. The vote carries 5-0. The election is moved. Thank you, Laura.
Thanks, Laura.
Thank you.
Okay, we now have, we're not quite at the hearing time yet for the next hearing. We could go ahead and do minutes. Want to do that? Barry, I have your comments here, and I think Paula does also. Do we have a motion to approve the September 1st meeting minutes, please?
I'm going to read this entirety.
Yeah.
One.
Move the Board of Selectmen close the hearing for the early opening.
Where am I? Sorry, we moved ahead.
Minutes.
You got minutes.
Yes.
We have already six something.
Move the Board of Selectmen approve the minutes of September 1st, 2015 as amended.
Is that seconded? Barry, do you want to go over your change?
Yeah, I just, real briefly, in when we had the discussion of under communications where we talked about taking positions on, potentially the Board of Selectmen taking positions on statewide legislation, I had made some comments that were not reflected in the record, so I just added them and would amend them to this to these minutes.
Those are consistent with my recollection.
Yep, mine as well.
Okay, so as amended, the motion has been made.
Actually,
yes, John?
Do you want to vote on the amendment, or is it necessary?
I don't think it's necessary. Okay. It's sort of accepted as a friendly amendment, main motion.
Question elsewhere in the minutes. I wasn't here, obviously, but the discussion regards citizens reaching out to individual selectmen. I've read the minutes, but mm-hmm. What was the conclusion? I have a certain opinion.
In terms of, this is the communication policy?
Yes.
Okay.
Should selectmen respond to individual comments?
The rule of thumb is it's best if citizens, if they send it to all the selectmen, the response should come from either myself or Bob.
Right.
Possibly also the vice chair if I'm not able to respond in a timely way. In no case should a quorum deliberate and exchange remarks among each other by email or serially by phone. Or
but you described it as a rule of thumb. Is it anything more formal than that?
Not really. If any board member has a thought or an idea, send it to the chair and Bob. It going in reverse.
I support what you're saying, by the way.
Yeah, that should be the thrust of what the minutes said.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, any other comment, Bob?
If I could, if any selectman got an individual email, it's best to direct it to me because it's possible you've all got the same individual email.
That's true.
So we want to make sure we coordinate a response.
The one concern I have is whenever I've been contacted, it's inevitable that the response I give will be looked at through the lens of probably the performance on this board. I mean, while I know people socially, I more often get letters from people that I don't circulate with. And they're reaching up because of the position we have on the board. So I'm inclined to work through Bob and the board and respond as a group. Otherwise, I'm fearful that our comments individually are misinterpreted. Right.
It's always appropriate to send any inquiry to the chair and Bob at the same time, and then but to know other people, because then that keeps just two selectmen in the loop.
At any time.
Any further comments on the minutes? Hearing none, the motion has been made to approve the minutes as amended. Yes, it's all set. I'll call for the vote. Again, it's going to have to be roll call. John Halsey, approving the minutes of September 1st. How about you? Still with us, John? Okay, Barry?
Yes.
Yes. John?
Abstain.
Yes. I vote yes, the vote being 4-0-1, the motion carries. Okay. Let's see. Anything else you want to say, Bobby? Can we maybe just say a few preliminary words about the warrant while we have a few minutes waiting?
I think you can begin.
Go ahead, we're a little bit early.
51.
Right, it's going to be yours here. 5D, can we have a reading of the notice for the hearing on the Tread LLC.
To the inhabitants of the town of Reading, please take notice that the Board of Selectmen of the town of Reading will hold a public hearing on September 15, 2015 at 7:55 p.m. in the Selectmen's Meeting Room, 16 Lowell Street, Reading, Massachusetts, on request for early opening at 5 a.m. for Tread LLC, 6 Linden Street. A copy of the proposed document regarding this topic is available in the town manager's office, 16 Lowell Street, Reading, Mass., Monday, Wednesday, and Thursday from 7:30 a.m. to 5:30 p.m., Tuesday from 7:30 a.m. to 7 p.m., and is attached to the hearing notice on the website at www.readingma.gov. All interested parties are invited to attend the hearing or may submit their comments in writing or by email prior to 6 p.m. on September 15, 2015 to the town manager at ci.reading.ma.us.
Thanks, Kevin. I'd like to welcome the folks from Tread tonight. Stay right where you are. Your voice will be picked up on the mic. Now, would you like to introduce yourself for the audience, please?
I'm Lori Haverty, one of the owners.
Lori.
Hi, I'm Tiffany Freitas, co-owner.
Would you like to just state your reasons for requesting the early opening?
Sure, that'd be great. I'll talk first. We opened up Tread about, it's been 6 weeks now. So we are very committed to bringing fitness to Reading, and we're focused on being a spin studio as well as small group fitness. We have a pretty diverse demographic of people that come in. We've got a lot of people that have a lot of stuff going on, as I'm sure everybody here has, with you know, just trying to balance work and family and all that, and all of those pieces of their lives. And so we've gotten over 100 requests to start earlier and to offer classes at 5:15. We've gotten people that have written us letters. There's been a lot of Facebook posts asking us to offer that. And then, you know, within fitness is the prime time for fitness studios. Every studio and the other six studios of Reading and previously the Reading Rack all have classes that start around the 5 a.m. time frame. It's just pretty fundamental to our business, and being able to meet the kind of the core demographic that we're targeting to be able to open at 5.
Okay. Have you been contacted by any of your neighbors regarding concerns about noise?
Yes. I actually love to walk through that about kind of how we've been handling the noise issues.
Okay.
We knew when we were starting this that, you know, we're in a commercial area, but there's a house that's
right
pretty.
Behind me is their location, just to be clear, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yep. And you can see that that there's a house very close to this. So even though we're in a commercial area, you know, our building's been around since about 1930. You know, the community's kind of been building up around us. And so before we even started construction, we went over to meet with the neighbors to tell them about what we were doing. We spent over $20,000 on noise proofing and soundproofing. It did everything from the ceiling to the walls to the boxes on the windows to the material underneath our flooring.
Our door is 500 pounds, literally.
And we're right across from the funeral home, and so it was really important to us not to disturb the people going in for that.
Right.
And so for a number of reasons besides just the neighbors was being respectful for that. So we spent about $20,000 with that, and then we ended up having a problem with the subwoofer. We have a pretty powerful subwoofer, and so we've been working with the neighbors. We brought in two sound engineers, and we now basically have it turned down to the absolute lowest setting. I'm the only person that knows, she doesn't even know how to change it, how to change the subwoofer, and that was a big problem in the beginning. But we've been working with the neighbors next to us to get it so that it's below what they can hear. And so that's really helped out. So we've gone over there probably, this problem ended about a couple weeks ago, but we've gone over there probably 6 or 8 times to make sure we got it to the right level for them. And so, you know, talking to them, they said that they actually have to put their head outside their window now to be able to hear it. And we were able to solve the main part of their problem.
And just to make it clear, there was never that noise of the music that they could hear. It was the pounding of the bass. So once we had our engineer come back in, and Tiffany and they took care of that, they've no longer heard it, from what we understand.
Bob, could you point out the addresses at both 14 and 22 Linden on that map?
One of them is right here, I think.
Oh, that far away.
Okay. There's 22. And
14? We received communications from both those homeowners today saying that the problem still existed. And the letter was dated today in both cases. One was an email, one was a note.
It seems to be
a little bit at odds with what you're telling me.
Yeah, so what I'm wondering with those, you know, just because we haven't been able to hear it that far down the road, it never occurred to me to talk to them about what they're hearing. Bob shared with me the letters and how they were describing it. It sounded like a bass issue,
yeah.
So I'm wondering if we actually solved their problem already. It also kind of highlighted a microphone issue, so that was the first I heard of. In the last 2 days is the first we've heard of that. So I'm going to get a new mixer so that we can turn on the mic a little bit. But I'm wondering if those letters were from before we were able to fix the bass.
Well, they were dated today. That's all I can say.
Today.
Yes.
My husband and I live at 12 and 14. Well, we live at 12. Our daughter lives
downstairs. Could you identify yourself for the
group? I'm Karen German.
Okay.
We own 12 and 14 Linden Street. Okay. It's a two-family right across the patio from number 10 Linden Street, to where the first people would complain about the noise. I thought a nightclub moved into the neighborhood, really. That's how loud it was.
Yeah.
What these people are saying, my neighbor never said that to me. She said something. She's still hearing it, she says. So it's a bit of a conflict there. The thing is, I don't hear the music so much now, or the microphone, nor does my daughter, but we still hearing this really loud boom, boom, boom. It is so loud, it vibrates the house. I can hear it under my pillow.
You heard that today?
Yes.
Yeah,
and it's worse.
In the last 2 weeks?
Yes. Today, yesterday. It's worse on the weekends because there's no traffic in the area that kind of muffles it, and no trains coming into the station at that hour in the morning. But unless that issue is resolved, I cannot conceive being woken up at 5 o'clock in the morning listening to that. I'm sorry.
So I brought the sound engineer out to and we've put on the songs that have the highest bass. It's below 50 decibels, and I can
travels though in different ways. It's
and I'd love to come
worse.
If you let us know, we would love to come with our sound engineer and see what you're hearing in your house, because we fixed it for the apartment next to us.
I don't know that it's fixed. That's not
right.
What they.
They were actually at our grand opening party, and
let's address the chair, please.
I'm sorry.
Everybody.
The people that were next door that did have the complaints in the beginning, as all of the neighbors were, they were invited to the party and they came and they, we had the music on and they said that they haven't heard a thing. Again on Sunday at the Fall Street Fair, they came as a family. Our kids go to school together. I see them at the school, and they said that they thank us every time we see them because we did do what they asked us to do.
And they have
and paid again to get those engineers back in to do what they had asked.
And in the two neighboring apartments, they have my cell phone number, and so they're gonna. One of them comes into for classes, and the other one is gonna start coming in for classes, and has said how much better it is. It's literally our biggest time slot is that 5 a.m. slot. All the other gyms in Reading have that time slot, and
Mr. Arena,
a couple thoughts. The motion or hearing before us is for early opening at 5, so there's no present restriction at 6 a.m. or later.
Is that by right?
Correct.
6 or whatever.
So it strikes me that there's an opportunity here for the abutters and the business to come to agreement without interfering with the majority of the enterprise's activities. I'd like to clarify one comment I think I heard. You said that the issues of the adjacent apartment were addressed. Is that the property in yellow on the screen you're talking about?
That's right. Do you mind if I go up and point? So here's the spin room right here, and then this is the adjacent apartment there. They have windows there, and so these are the people we've been kind of that we talk to a lot and have been working with.
And could you point out where the is it Jermaine?
German.
Where yours?
Right there.
Right here. Right.
And the one above it as well.
The Blunts are here too. They're 22.
Two of them.
22.
The Blunts are.
Oh, they're up here.
Right.
Yeah.
Sorry.
The thing is, there's an empty patio in front of 10 Linden Street. It's like a quadrangle. So there's nothing to block any sound that comes from that building. We've never had any noise problem at all. I've lived there for 65 years. I've seen a lot of things come and go. And I'm not saying we don't want them there. They're welcome to be there. They can open at 5 o'clock, but they've got to be quiet. We can't be waking up people at the break of dawn, literally.
How many people do you generally have in your classes?
About 15 or 20.
This may sound like a silly thought, but I've been to other, they tend to be evening parties with music, but people distribute headphones now. They're really good.
Oh, I was thinking of that.
And there's absolutely no ambient noise, and you can kill people with the sound.
The problem is the physical movement, and so we've got everybody, the physical movement of being in an open studio, people are jumping up and down.
Yeah, they're doing what you're asking them to do.
Yeah, we can't stop the jumping noise, but the bass, the subwoofer bang.
Oh, no, but they would lose the headphones. You couldn't do it with headphones on.
Oh, I see.
Yeah.
We've thought about, it seemed as though what we were told was it was the microphone, and I don't know if you can tell from my voice, I've tried to teach without the microphone, and it's actually now sounds like this, and it's really not healthy. So I've tried to do other things that, you know, just to help them and not upset any neighbors, of course, because I as well have always lived in Reading and want to give more to this community than, and not the negative, of course.
Yeah, Barry.
So is it the noise from the exercise floor?
No,
is it the spinning?
Boom, boom, boom.
Subwoofer and the microphone.
Like somebody turns the
bass. Right, but is that during the spinning piece of it or the actual floor?
I have no
floor?
Idea what they're doing.
So
one at a time.
Yeah, so I think the boom, boom, boom is a little bit new for us because we thought in the working with the engineers and the neighbors that we could solve that problem. So what I had understood was that 1 out of 10 classes, they can sometimes, if the instructor is particularly loud, they can hear the microphone. And so what I had said to them was, oh, I'll go out and get a mixer. But I had only heard about it a couple days ago, so I haven't gotten a chance to go buy a new mixer.
So we can separate and turn down
the mics down.
Right now they're in one. So you can turn the mic down and the music will sit over the microphone instead of being together.
But the neighbor had said to us that that bass sound was, you know, it was night and day from where it used to be. And so I thought we'd fixed it, but clearly if they're hearing it in the last couple of days, I don't know. I go outside into the neighborhood all the time. I've got to do this, always listening and monitoring the sound. And I didn't actually know, I thought you could hear it in the 4 feet away. The idea of going that far and still being able to hear it, it must be a difference of being indoors than outdoors, because you can't hear the music that far away being outdoors, but I totally understand sound travels funny, and maybe you can hear it indoors.
Right. Is there any other questions from the board?
Just real quickly, you said that it's no longer so much the microphone or the noise level, but it's the bass level? Is that
it's the bass.
That's what you're hearing?
I'm telling you, it vibrates in my pillow and wakes me up. And my husband works 10-hour days, overtime, extra days. On his day off, he doesn't want to get up at 4:30 in the morning like he has to. So it's not bothering him in the morning, except for when his day's off, and he gets woken up too.
So and, that bass was taken care of. It sounds like the other issues have been addressed as well.
Well, my bedroom isn't in the same place as my daughter's bedroom. She says she still hears the microphone and the music. My bedroom is more in the corner of the house. But for me, it's the boom, boom, and the vibration. See, these houses are old, you know, they're very sensitive. We've been living with the railroad station, you know, all my life, ever since I was born. But it's a sound that comes and goes, but it vibrates the house when they're idling at the station. I mean, I'm sitting in my kitchen literally like this sometimes. It's that loud, especially since they put those big, huge engines on the train. It's like it's right in your backyard. But it comes and goes. When this first started, I thought it was somebody, a client of Snap Fitness, who left their car radio on. I had no idea where the sound was coming from. In fact, we were all asking each other, what is that noise? Where is that coming from? And then my next door neighbor at 10 Linden Street asked me one day if the noise from tread was bothering me. I said, is that where that's coming from? Literally, I'm not kidding, and I have no grudge against these girls. I think it's wonderful what they're doing, but I mean, it sounded like a nightclub at first.
No, it's fair.
It really did.
In regards to your sound engineer,
what
did they just address those two? Did they not address the bass component when they came out and did it? Or
sounds
like that's new to you that, you know,
the bass
this.
Component was the biggest issue from the beginning. I actually agree with her. You could actually hear it pretty far away. And so, we systematically kept turning it down, and now it's on the absolute lowest setting it can be on, and I've gone over to the neighbor's house next to me, like probably 3 or 4 times since we turned it on, that trying out different very heavy bass songs to make sure she couldn't hear it, and you can't hear it there at all. She's actually said you have to put your head outside to be able to hear it.
And these are the folks at 10?
The 10, the one that's adjacent.
Okay, one right next to it. Okay.
Yeah. So from what I had understood from the neighbors in the closest building to us, we had fixed the bass problem. But what I was hearing was that it was every 10 songs the microphone, but I only heard about it 2 days ago, so I haven't been able to
fix
that.
I noticed some folks came in late to the hearing, and I certainly want to give everybody an opportunity to speak here. Is there anybody else? This is a public hearing, so feel free to introduce yourself and make your comment. Yes.
I'm Deanna Adele, 122 Linden Street. I don't actually hear it at my house, but I was outside there today in the car on very close to the exercise place, and you can hear it perfectly well outside. And it's the beep, beep, beep. It's like a drum constantly going. And the young lady is shouting out instructions to the people that are in there. And that's just as loud. It's a very loud noise. So I sympathize with my neighbors. If I go over there, I can hear it. And if you're walking by, you can certainly hear it outside. That's why I suggested in my note that somebody go when they have a class going and just, you know, check it out for yourselves.
Can you actually hear it from your house further up the street?
Not from my house, okay, necessarily, because I'm not outdoors that much. Right. But definitely, if you're walking by, you hear it. I was over by the gorillas in the car, and I could hear it. We were both together. I made a point of it because I wanted to be sure of what I was saying before I came up here.
Thank you. Any other comments?
The thing is, I just want to say that it's not the rest of the day that's the problem. They close at 8 o'clock at night. There's no problem there. Yeah. It's that hour. You know, most people are sleeping at 6 o'clock, 6:30 in the morning. My husband's the only one who gets up at 4:30. But I mean, you know, and I won't bring up the age thing, but you know, it's hard to get back to sleep.
Okay. Can I say just one more thing just about operating a business in Reading? So, you know, I think Lori and I, you know, we're both come from kind of old Reading families, and, you know, opening a business for us in Reading has been kind of a lifelong dream of ours. Lori's been in the fitness industry for 20 years here, and it hasn't just been about our business, it's been actually about supporting a lot of the other businesses. We've actually been very blessed in the success of our business since inception, and we've kind of gone under the belief system that kind of all boats can rise with the tide, and so it's been really important for us to help other businesses as well. You can, you know, a couple of the other kind of fitness studios have also struggled with and it's been important in One Powered Yoga, Snap Fitness, and everything that we do, we've been helping kind of promote their business as well, sending our following over to them to try to help some of the businesses here. One of the reasons why, you know, it's really fundamental to us to open in the morning is because people don't come to the gym in the middle of the day. It's they come in the morning and they come in the evening. They come before work and after work. And the trains leave Reading at 7:30, 8 o'clock, and they want to get a workout in. It's the top place in Reading right now to get your workout in. And it's a top, not because, it's because we bring a certain kind of sense of community, we bring people together, we've been very respectful to everybody that we've kind of been working with, and we really want to be, we want to obviously be successful in Reading, but we also want to help other businesses be successful here too. And, you know, this is pretty fundamental to our business model, and we've invested tens of thousands of dollars in soundproofing to do that.
And just, if I can say something too, just to reiterate a little bit of that. We chose this building because it meant something to us. Growing up in this town, Betty's Thrift Shop was where I grew up. My father died, I was 8 years old, my mother had four kids to raise, and that's where we shopped. And raising my daughter in this town, making her proud about where I grew up, is just as important as running a business in this town. And I could have gone on Main Street, I could have chose the old Rack when it closed. We chose Betty's for more than just a business. We work with Annie, we speak with her almost every day. She's a part of this, and we want to make sure we make everybody happy. And I just feel like what we do in this town as a community is very important for people to come together. And if we had known that it had bothered people down the road, we would have made changes already. We made the changes for our neighbors because that's all we thought we had to make them for. So with an apology, of course, we don't want to upset anyone or wake anybody up. But I also want you guys to know that no matter, at 41 years old, growing up in this town means just as much to me as it does for people who've lived here 65 years. And it's very important that you guys know that as well.
Thank you. Those same things are important to me, too.
Just a second. Are there any objective noise standards that we're dealing with here in the bylaws?
Fortunately, the town engineer's here. No, I don't think there's anything in the
bylaws. There's no decibel levels.
No. But the standard is not an objective standard. It's a subjective standard, which is there's no detrimental effect. And I take all the comments made moments ago to heart.
that the applicants have nothing but the best of intentions for the residents of Reading. Bob, is there an opportunity for this matter to be brought up, if not decided tonight, brought up at any subsequent meetings?
You can not vote to close the hearing, just leave it open until your next meeting, and they can work together. October 4th is the next selectmen's meeting.
The other thing I would also kind of propose, I know that this is an annual thing, that you can't just still get this in perpetuity. So, you know, it's also coming up again on around December 1st.
Well, if you get the problem solved, that should be pro forma. You don't have to go through all this again.
But you have an immediate opportunity to do it after 6 o'clock with the acceptance of things.
Yeah, I think there are very good intentions here. I'm not sure that the objective outcomes are quite what they need to be if these problems are persisting. So my inclination as one member of the board would be to leave this hearing open and see what can be done, either about lowering sound levels. I know you folks have spent good money on this, and I think that's been done in good faith. But is there any other operational changes you can think of to lessen the impact? I personally would actually like to visit the site once you've gotten it more quiet and see for myself what it sounds like before I vote on this. So I'd be inclined to want to continue the hearing.
My recommendation is that you all are in violent agreement. You don't want to make noise.
Violent agreement.
And you don't want to hear noise.
Right.
And there's a natural alignment of your interests.
Yes.
You could, if we leave the hearing open tonight, you have the opportunity to return at the next meeting once the issue is addressed. You have a natural, all the comments made about addressing it in December, if it's not resolved, apply to addressing it tomorrow. You could work on it tomorrow, next week, the week after, and as soon as your abutting neighbors agree, we would reconvene the hearing and would proceed from that point. But it's quite difficult for me to, in no other case where we've had 5 o'clock opening for an athletic event, whether it's been SNAP or the RAC when it was around or a dozen or so others, have we heard a scintilla of complaint.
Part of that is this may be the one that's closest to a butter's.
Absolutely, that's contributing to it. I think the style of it is probably more prone to doing it. And there's nobody more prone business in this town than I am. The standard we're being held to that there's no detrimental effect to the operation on the town or the immediate abutting neighbors, and as evidenced here tonight, that's not achieved.
And I just, you know, kind of with that, you know, I've gone to the police station a bunch of times trying to figure out what is the decibel. Give me a decibel level to get below, and we'll hit it. But it is exactly what you said. It's a subjective standard.
It's below hearing is why you can't do it with a meter. It's below the level you can hear. But
the subjectivity is an issue.
But subjectivity is an issue, and I don't think the intention was ever to get us to zero, because I don't think that was ever realistic. But, you know, standing outside and talking at this level, you know, standing outside the building and talking at this level in the patio area, if this is the same volume as kind of what the music is, is that reasonable? Like, you know, and you know, those are the types of questions that we've been kind of, you know, grappling with, because it is hard, because all of our competitors are opening, we're in a commercial space, we've invested tens of thousands of dollars. We're probably one of the top performing fitness studios too, and this would severely handicap our ability to perform. It would have to make us think about
our business model change.
We'd have to move after investing tens of thousands of dollars.
I don't understand why in a building that small, and I've been in there just like they have, Betty's thrift shop and the boutique and everything, why they need that much sound in such a small building. It must be detrimental to their ears. I can see why she has to scream, turn it up, turn it down, and you'll probably get, people will hear you, and your session.
Can
I finish, please? I went online and I read their spiel about their business, and every other word is beep, 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 beep. Now, do they have to have that high impact beat class that early in the morning? Could it be as simple as just moving that class to 8 o'clock or something? I know it might not be in line with what they want at 5 o'clock, because maybe women want to get in there and do that, you know, high impact thing at that hour. But I'm saying they can open it all night if they want to. I don't want to know they're there. The worst thing for me is the vibration. A little bit of boom, boom, boom,
I got
you know, is normal.
Yes.
Can I just answer that real quick? So, you know, in terms of where the fitness industry is going these days, small fitness studios are kind of the place where people choose to do their classes. The number one thing is spin across the country. You have, you can see MindBody's IPO in terms of the types of businesses their technology supports. You can look at SoulCycle and their IPO. This is where the industry is heading. And if you look at Wakefield, the number one fitness studio in Wakefield is Sweat. The number one in Woburn is Fit House. And these are the places that are having the exact type of experience that we're doing. We'd like to think that ours is a little bit different from that, but we can't change our classes. They're coming in for that reason.
Question. Yes, Sherry.
I actually visited the studio during the fall fair, and it was really impressive. You see the quality of the work that went into it. Mm-hmm. And I think, I mean, I'm inclined to want to get them to the point where they can open up at 5 o'clock for the simple fairness reason. There are other studios that while they're not in a residential area, open up at 5. And you know, they're a business. They might do something a little bit differently than somebody else. But you know, there's still the whole question of fairness. They need to compete and make a living so that they stay there. That said, it really is incumbent upon you to really work with the neighbors. And whether that is, you know, doing the headphone thing, changing the classes around, you know, I disagree. You know, there's going to be some noise. It's not going to get to zero. I mean, that's just the nature of what they do. But there still needs to be a little bit more work done to try to mitigate some of the impact.
I'm not sure, not hearing anything from the street is a reasonable level of restriction,
right. Yeah.
But I certainly think people should not be woken up by this in any sense at 5 in the morning, wherever they live. I'd be down your throat too if you were waking me up at 5 in the morning.
Whether it's the sound engineer, maybe tweaking some things, maybe it's the headphone, maybe you try to, you know, at least on the cycles you can.
And it is unfortunate. This is a somewhat unique situation relative to your competitors, because you are very close to residential. Therefore, it's more incumbent, and I think you have made a good step down the journey you need to, but there must be something else that can be done here.
Yeah, I just wish that we've been working so hard with the neighbors. We've invested so much time, so much money in trying to have good relationships with our neighbors, working on this. And it's really frustrating that the first time that we're hearing that these problems weren't solved wasn't actually directly to us, was through this forum.
So you didn't hear these complaints before?
No,
directly?
From them. No. Not from them.
I
We've been working
you
with
did.
A neighboring building the whole time. We've been soliciting input.
Okay.
And the actual time that the neighboring building complained, the police had come down,
yeah.
They actually knocked on their door and said, "We cannot hear one thing."
And just to speak to that, I actually did walk down there before our meeting tonight. They had a class going at the time.
Yeah.
And you can definitely tell that they did a lot of sound blocking, sound muffling, whatever you will. You hear it as you walk past mm-hmm. the studio going up the street towards your house. There's a bush line directly in front of 10, mm-hmm. Right where you see the little... What would be a little grass here, that little white area, a little mouse there, down a little bit. Yeah, right there.
I think I would encourage
that you don't, once you get about midway past that, you really don't hear it. Now, it's that hearing it doesn't mean that you don't get the vibration coming down
it's
the street.
It's vibration more than anything.
Yeah, and
like
that's
I
what
said,
it seems like is
the
problem.
Doesn't
okay.
bother me.
In
the vibration.
Your, the one thing I would say, in fairness to Tread LLC, those homes are business zoned, not residentially zoned as well. And that's a semantical
I think it's
argument, but
people
it's,
live there.
I understand that. I think it's an important point that they've worked with them to this point. And you know, is there some kind of stay that we can give them at a trial period?
Let's continue. Why don't we continue the hearing, and each of us can make our own field trip to that site and have an objective assessment.
Yeah, no, listen, I agree with that. I think the best objective assessment is going to come from the folks down the street.
Spend the night in here.
Yeah. Well,
and, you know, and what I'm saying is, you know, if there is a problem, the best way to figure it out is to actually to open the problem up. In other words, let's see what that problem is. I hate to say, you know, wake you up, but let's see if that does. If at 5 a.m., if the noise levels that they're using would wake them up, could we give them, rather than saying through December, say through to the next, you know, middle or second meeting in October, to come back before us, and if there are now still complaints and they haven't addressed them,
we can look at it from that perspective. Is that not something that we can do here tonight? It's either vote for it, yay or nay, or keep it open. Is that what we have in front of us?
You can put anything you want on the license.
Okay.
So the license by default would be through December 31st. Put any date you want on it.
The gentleman in the back first.
Yeah, just a wild thought.
Sure. Could you introduce yourself, sir?
Bill Andrews from Roma Lane, Reading.
Okay.
Could you guys give a contingency to them that says, we still don't have to wait all the way to October, where it's the middle of September, that if they work with these people, the abutters, to get the sound to where they want it, the abutters send you guys a letter or an email that says, we go out there, mm-hmm. they get what they need, and you guys can then approve it by email? Does it have to wait?
Can't do it by email.
No, we could.
Good thought, though.
For the next meeting, we could take this
up. We could put a time limit on that, on the approval of it. You know, give them time to work it out. It sounds like this has just come to their attention now. A month doesn't seem like a lot of time, but that's certainly a lot of lost customers.
So you're suggesting we maybe make this December 31st date October 6th, given a 3-week draw?
Yeah.
I would just ask them if they would find any value in being open for three
yes.
weeks.
Yeah, and I was just going to, just to, for both of you, I'm the one who does the classes. I offer what, you know, I put the schedule together. I can offer at 5:15 a.m. lower intensity classes. That was never asked to us. No one's okay. asked us what we're offering at that time. They can be offered a little bit less. I'm probably not going to lie, the loudest one. So maybe I don't instruct them at this point. But I can put the schedule together within that trial period that it's not something that you necessarily play loud or you hear loud. And I can make that happen. I'm not willing to not work with them, but it is huge to our business right now. This is, for gyms or studios, September and October is better than January. Their kids are in school, everyone is starting to figure out where they're gonna go. This is where we need to.
And people are figuring out their schedules and they're choosing where they're going. So we're a little bit worried if we have to wait another month for this, that people are gonna choose other places to go, other towns offer the spin, and so they might, you know, just get into their regular cycle with them, and this is the biggest 2 months for us.
All right, so what would, if we wanted to do this for 3 weeks, what would be the procedure, Bob?
I'm not sure 3 weeks is really enough for this. Right. I'd suggest October 20th.
The second meeting?
Yeah.
Will we have a whole new hearing then, or can you continue
close the hearing and vote on something tonight.
And we have to give a contingent.
Right. And we'll just post another hearing. That's not a problem. We just need some time to post.
Second hearing.
But it's going to take some time for all these folks to work something out, and 3 weeks is pretty short, honestly.
Yeah, and my idea behind it really is this is one of those things that you really can't work out on paper. Mm-hmm. It's something that you need to probably tweak a little bit here and there.
Right.
I assume. Is it something that you would be amenable to having us do tonight?
On paper?
No, it would you be amenable to saying that we're not just going to strictly approve them, but we're going to set a time limit for them to
right.
make sure that they're not disrupting
right.
the neighborhood?
And they need to stick to it, because I don't want
yeah.
this to
And that's the time limit. So when they come back to us in October and you say, no, it's even worse or it hasn't gotten better,
yeah.
you know, that may change the board vote at that point. But
hopefully,
you know, I think they seem genuine in working with you. Hopefully at that time you'd say, yeah, it's really not a big deal.
I also want to address your comment about it being business zone from my house down to 6 Linda Street. Those three buildings are business zone.
Mm-hmm.
They've been residential for 100 years.
Right.
Okay. And nobody wants to change the zoning.
Yeah.
So we're stuck with the business thing.
Yeah,
and
there's
no
that.
Reason for anybody to move in there with something that doesn't conform to
no,
the
absolutely.
Piece of the neighborhood. And I like these people. I mean, her sister went to school with my daughter. I went to school with her parents. It feels very uncomfortable for me to sit here and have to address
right
this situation like this. I don't want to be confrontational. Ooh. It's just that people are sleeping
yeah,
at that
absolutely.
Hour in the morning.
No,
it must be beautiful
it.
For people who are in there, boom, boom, boom. I can understand that. I was young once.
We're trying to get the yes
you know?
For everybody. Yeah.
But I mean, not at that hour of the moment and of the morning. I mean, I don't care what other time of the day. They can be bang, clash,
I don't
boom.
Think it's an either or. I think we
yeah.
can get to some accommodation.
I want to make sure everyone understands. So what's being discussed now mm-hmm. is the potential to allow the tread to open at 5 a.m. for the next 6 weeks?
Five weeks.
Five
weeks.
Weeks.
Yeah.
during which the neighbors will continue to assess the level and tolerance.
And the selectmen.
And the adjustment, and thereby the selectmen.
I'll do a selectmen class.
At which point another hearing, or actually the license would expire and another hearing would be scheduled.
Right.
And you all would show back up again and register your opinion. Now, for us here, that puts us in a very different role. Now, we're being asked whether to extend the current hearing while it can be adjusted to their satisfaction. This proposal.
I don't think we can. No.
I think Bob just said we have to close it and actually vote to approve.
We do another hearing.
We could extend this hearing to the October 6th.
Well, you can't give them permission.
We can't give them permission,
right,
I agree.
Right, correct. Yeah.
But they could, after 6 o'clock in the morning, make accommodations that the neighbors could gauge to be sufficient.
Okay.
Whereupon, at our next meeting, we could say, go ahead.
Two-step process.
Hang on, but what's been proposed actually does the opposite. If there's still no approval and as of the 20th, we're going to be put in the position of saying they think it's good enough, they say it's not, and we're the bad guys. And be mindful, I could be okay either way, but the standard is no detrimental effect on the immediate abutting neighbors. So we're just trading the decision process to fix it now versus fix it on the 6th and dealing with the on the 20th and fixing it then. And the problem with that is if it's not fixed by the 20th, for the folks at TRID, it's very unlikely you'll get an extension.
The only thing is we did, so it, my bad, I misunderstood the 48 hours in advance. So I tried to get on the last one, but I didn't understand business days. And then, so now we waited till this one, and then to have to wait again, we're starting to miss the window. And to be honest, we actually thought we could open at 5 when we first started, and so we didn't know that this was a step, and obviously, rightly so, but if we push it out more, it is detrimental to the business.
Gentleman in the back. Yeah.
Bill Anderson, I think you were there. I mean, if you give them 5 weeks, and they don't get these people to agree, I mean, they've got every incentive in the world to go over every day and say, how's it going?
Absolutely.
Because they're
going
to lose their license in 5 weeks if they don't.
That's really the message.
So this is perfectly set up to have the business work with the abutters till the abutters say yes, because without a yes from the abutters, they're going to lose the license in 5 weeks. So it's massively set up for success.
I agree, but do you folks understand what's being said? If it doesn't work by the 20th under this proposal, it's done.
And it's their opinion against ours?
I don't want that.
No, it's going to be our decision.
It's our decision, but if they report back that the level of satisfaction isn't achieved, we're back where we are right now.
Stop. Doesn't their current permit allow them to operate from the hours of 6 p.m.?
Yes.
Yeah.
This is just
so we're not talking
it's just
about
that 1 hour.
Correct.
We're just talking the 1 hour here. We're not talking about shutting
correct.
It down.
Correct.
Did I hear that language?
No. But if we return on it,
I'm so sorry.
Do you know how bad I'm holding back tears right now?
If we return on the 20th and the neighbors still aren't satisfied,
all right,
we're in a position of having to not renew the license for the 5 to 6 window. That's the problem.
So
that's
one way or the other, we're going to have to make the decision.
That's correct.
And right now, I don't feel, I mean, I feel like this is the first time where all these folks are in the room at the same time. And, you know, I think I'm looking at you and you're doing this, saying that, yes, we're going to work with the neighbors.
Yes.
And I've talked, and I can see that you're, you know, want to keep
getting
them.
Yourself on a city.
So I'm okay with basically letting these folks have the opportunity to work together. And if they agree to disagree, then it's going to be our call.
Absolutely.
We have to make the call one way or the other.
Right.
Right.
And I just think that I'd rather let them try to do it themselves.
So you're saying close the hearing and approve the 5 a.m. opening now? Give them a provisional five weeks.
5 weeks.
Okay.
And then and in the interim, hopefully, we'll do our due diligence as selectmen and maybe as customers.
So I want to get our other party on the phone here. Mr. John Halsey, do you have any comments regarding this hearing? Just have to take a second for him to get back. John, you with us?
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Yeah. Turning you up a little bit.
I actually think that the idea of these parties working together during this 5 to 6 window on a short-term basis makes a lot of sense. You know, it's clear that if the business owners are not able to make this thing work, what they're dot essentially is a 5-week window for this 1 hour. And I'm going to guess that they're going to work very hard. They seem very conscientious about wanting to work with that space in Reading with the neighbors. It strikes me that what I heard from the neighbors are that they just want to not be locked out of their bed at 5 o'clock in the morning. It's not unreasonable. It seems like, you know, the business owners don't want to do that to them either. So, you know, it may take a couple of tries with the sound engineer and probably some investment of time and money to make this thing get calibrated and, you know, kind of everybody can go about their business, you know, going forward. The business owners can capture this window of, you know, this extra hour, which I understand is critical to their industry, and the neighbors will find a happy spot to be able to sleep past 5 o'clock in the morning. I think the best thing we can do as a body is to give that opportunity to these people who don't seem to be adversarial, really. They seem to like to make it work out. That's what I would think, is that let this business open at 5 o'clock, working very closely with the neighbors, especially those neighbors who are most impacted that responded to us today, and let them get started with that right away, and let's hope that we get to a good resolution probably long before the October 20th. That's where I would be coming from. I would say that it would be a good idea for us to let them work together.
Thank you, John. Okay, is there any further public comment or comment from the board? Yes. Oh, yes, Adele.
I just have one question. Why does it have to be so loud in the first place that it can't be contained within the building? You're ruining people's hearing down the road. You may not realize it, but you are. You're healthy. You're making the body healthy in one sense, and you're hurting something else. But why can't this noise be just sort of contained within the building now that I can be outside and hear it when I'm in my car across the street and the young lady shouting? She's not doing her voice any good either. I should think we'd be a happy meeting here.
I ask the same question when I hear certain cars drive by me. I can hear the bass half a block away.
Exactly.
If I can answer that, we do offer air plugs.
Yes.
So people, and that's just what spin studios do. And just, not that this has anything to do with the spin studio, but I was at Christopher's the other day. I love it there. I eat there every weekend, waiting out front. And I heard the people inside their entire conversation, who they were speaking about, why they were speaking about them. So it's not just a spin studio, it's the way that things are built. I mean, I'm fine with lowering and doing all of what you are asking, but it's the base of the business. It's what people want. They come to our studio because of what we've built and what we've offered them.
Yeah.
And if we change it to a point where it's, like we've said, to zero, then 5 o'clock doesn't matter because then there's no interest
in
what we're doing.
Anyway.
No one's gonna come anyway.
Are you folks concerned about your protection? I mean, is this decibel level?
I mean, just so you know, for me, I go to the throat doctor, and I go all the time. And even though I sound like this, as healthy as I am, and I take care of it in a way that you would as a singer. Singers, they tell you what to do with your ears and your throat, and that's how.
Right.
So.
Do we have further comments from anyone? Okay, I will entertain a motion to either close or continue. Sounds like we're until the closing, Bob, did you ever?
I just have a comment. From the discussion you've had, it looks like the only change to the main motion would be number 2 and a date.
Yes, yep. October 20th. All right, is there a motion to close the hearing?
Move the Board of Selectmen close the hearing for the early opening for Tread LLC at 6 Linden Street.
Okay, is that seconded?
Second.
Mr. Arena seconds. We're going to do a roll call vote. John Halsey, how do you vote to close the hearing? Oh, sorry, John, we might have gotten you lower here. Did you vote on closing the hearing? Still with us?
Yes, 5 seconds away. For vote to close the hearing?
Yes.
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 Okay.
Yes.
Mr. Berman?
Yes.
Mr. Sexton?
Yes.
Mr. Arena?
Yes.
Yes, so we are 5-0 to close the hearing. And I think we should probably read the whole thing here.
Yep.
Yep.
Move that the Board of Selectmen approve a license to operate a retail business between the hours of midnight and 6 a.m. pursuant to Section 7.1 of the Reading General Bylaws, and further pursuant to Section 3.9 of the Board of Selectmen Policies, to Tread LLC, 6 Linden Street, subject to the following conditions. This license is for approval pursuant to the Board of Selectmen Regulation 3.9, to open for business not earlier than 5 a.m. on Monday through Friday, and not earlier than 6 a.m. on Saturday, Sunday, and holidays. This approval, second, this approval expires at midnight, October 20th, 2015. And third, all signs shall conform to the zoning bylaws of the town of Reading.
Okay, is that seconded?
Second. There's a little more.
I think you got to, yeah.
Oh, I'm sorry.
It's a full motion here.
Take that second, Ben.
In granting this license, the board finds that in accordance with section 5.10.4 of the general bylaws, it is in the interest of the public health, safety, and welfare that public necessity or convenience will be served by permitting such operation, and there is no detrimental effect of such operation on the town or immediately abutting neighbors.
Now I'll take a second.
Second.
Okay, I'll poll the board again. This has to be a roll call vote. John Halsey, how do you vote?
Yes.
Barry Berman?
Yes.
Kevin Sexton?
Yes.
John Arena?
Yes.
And I vote yes. The vote is 5-0, so we will move ahead. We will process about this. We will re-advertise another hearing for the 20th, and we will adjudicate this one way or the other.
And the abutters that have arrived tonight, you're more than welcome to come back on that subsequent meeting and report back what progress has been made, if not before.
And we'll be checking as well.
We'll be checking as well.
Yeah. John, you have a comment?
Go ahead, John.
I think it's important that the, I'm convinced that the business owners are going to work very hard with the neighbors. The neighbors need to know that they don't need to wait until October 20th if they don't feel there's resolution.
Right.
I think it's really important that this is an active process between the business owners and the abutting neighbors, and that email box and phones are open between now and October 20th. I mean, at least that's the way I feel about it anyway. I don't think this is something that we ignore for 5 weeks and wait and see what happens.
Thank you, John. Okay.
And just real quick, I just wanted to say thank you to both for being willing to work. It's nice to see that, from business owner and resident standpoint, the two of you are willing to help each other out and come to that common goal, as John Arena had mentioned earlier. So thank you both.
Thanks, everybody.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right.
Yeah, if I might just let you know, we'll plan on an 8 p.m. public hearing. We'll let you
on
know.
The 20th?
On October 20th.
Okay.
It's not 8 p.m. I'll let you know.
Okay.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank all you right. for coming.
Good evening, everybody. Yeah. All right, we're going to move on to the hearing for private road acceptances. It was scheduled for 8. We're running a little late here. I think this will go more quickly, though. It's under 5E.
You need a motion. To the inhabitants of the town of Reading, please take notice that the Board of Selectmen of the town of Reading will hold a public hearing on September 15, 2015 at 8 p.m. in the Selectmen's Meeting Room, 16 Lowell Street, Reading, Massachusetts, on private road acceptances of Causeway Road, Quarry Lane, Dividends Road.
Go outside.
Oh, yeah, that's a good idea.
Can we call? Excuse me, folks, if you want to have a discussion, we have to continue our meeting. Could you do it out in the hall? Thank you. All right, you're welcome.
Thank you. Good luck.
Pond View, Roma Lane, and Sailor Tom's Way. A copy of the proposed document regarding this topic is available in the town manager's office, 16 Lowell Street, Reading, Mass. Monday, Wednesday, Thursdays from 7:30 a.m. to 5:30 p.m. Tuesdays from 7:30 a.m. to 7 p.m. and is attached to the hearing notice on the website at www.readingma.gov.
Thank you, Mr. Secretary. Just a couple of words. The streets that are listed here are streets that I guess you could kind of call them leftovers from prior subdivisions, things that have not. Do you want to say a few words?
Yeah. Yeah. First, thanks to Bill, who's been very patient for the last 3 or 4 years.
Yes.
Roma Lane put a petition together several years ago to have this happen. The streets fall into two categories. Causeway and Dividends are different. They're not parts of subdivisions. They're roads that have gone through a town meeting process previously but never been completed for a variety of reasons. But Dan is right. Quarry Lane, Pond View, Roma Lane, and Sailor Tom's Way were subdivisions and had intended to become public ways, and just that paperwork never completed. Mm-hmm. To take a further step back, when Bill had and his neighbors on Roma Lane had submitted a petition,
We took a step back, and the board will remember having a meeting with all public, all private road, you know, interested parties, and I had to step out. In the work that George Zamboros has done, and some of his fellow engineers, and Jesse Wilson, these are the six roads that are very clear that they can be turned into public roads, you know, if everyone's willing, for no cost.
Yep.
That there's no reason, the in some cases, the residents have already paid on Causeway a betterment. The rest of the roads, that's not clear. So any other private road, it'll be case by case. It's very likely to come through the board in a more typical way.
Any other road not mentioned here, you said?
Any private road not mentioned here, or any portions of private roads not mentioned here,
great,
may well incur costs.
And for instance, the very end of Dividends is not included in this acceptance, correct?
Correct, correct. So that's the background. These six can, I wasn't sure, but town council is perfectly fine to lump all six together in one article. CPDC voted three roads two meetings ago.
Mm-hmm.
They closed a condition on Quarry Lane last night. George and I were there, and they also recommended Causeway and Dividends, even though they're not technically part of the subdivision process, to be accepted by the board and by town meeting.
And you're stressing that in no case will additional betterments be assessed against any abutters on the accepted portions of these streets?
For these six roads, that's correct.
So everybody should know that. Yes, John.
Bob, in our package tonight is a letter from Mr. Curto. What's the resolution of that?
He was here several years ago when the selectmen also had a hearing on Causeway and insisted that it was a public road many years ago, but never was a public road.
Yeah, and thanks to the citizens of Causeway that took a petition around, I had suggested that to them, and they did a great job with that.
Yeah, and same with Dividends.
Yep.
Karen Herrick did a nice job.
Mm-hmm.
So I'll turn it over to George.
Okay.
Well, I thought I was going to be able to show you the actual taking plans, but the file's not showing up in my flash drive for some reason. I don't know why. As Bob said, there's six streets here. One of the first ones, so three of them are located in this area right here. Actually, let me go to the very first one. Sale of Tom's Way is a fairly new subdivision.
Mm-hmm.
It's actually completed about a year and a half ago. There was one outstanding issue on the survival of a tree.
Right.
That new tree has been transplanted. It's been accepted by the tree warden. Everything has been completed on the subdivision in accordance with the subdivision rules and regulations. And as Bob mentioned, that was on the August 24th, CPDC voted to declare the subdivision complete and recommend acceptance of the roadway. Roma Lane, there was an outstanding bond for approximately 6,000. Roma Lane was actually constructed under two subdivisions.
Carriage.
The first one was built most of the subdivision. The last portion of, which was called Carriage Estates, the last portion, basically the cul-de-sac, was built under Zachary and Corey Lane, which was Carriage Estates too. The first portion of the road was declared complete. The second portion had an outstanding bond for some minor work. All that work has been completed. And that one there, in addition, the CPDC voted to release the bond. There were some missing releases of house lots that were not recorded at the Registry of Deeds. They voted to release all the house lots, declared the subdivision complete, and the road's in good shape, and it's ready for acceptance. Corey Lane. This was one of the ones that there was actually some outstanding work left to be done. There was a bond on it.
Could you point to that?
Corey Lane, yep, is this portion right here.
Thank you.
This again was actually built in three phases. It's part of Carriage Hill 2 Estates. There was a separate portion of the road that was slightly improved upon through an A&R process, and then Carriage 3 Estates. There was $1,700 of bond left over. The August 24th meeting, the CPDC voted to seize the bond in order to complete the work. There was two manholes that had to be raised. That work has been done, and at the meeting last night, CPDC did vote to release the, all the lots from the covenant, restrictive covenant, declare the subdivision complete, and recommended acceptance. While there was a bond outstanding, the bank gave up the money. It was a joint bank account between the town and the developer. The bank released the money to the developer about 3 years ago. We have emailed the homeowner, because she actually came in. It was basically her husband's subdivision, and she did complete some work a few years ago. And we're trying to see if we can get the money off. I mean, it's the cost of two frames and covers. It wasn't a great deal of money. We spent less than $1,000. But all the work is now complete.
George, the other streets in that area, Zachary and...
Zachary, Gregory, right. there is still outstanding work for there to do. There's stone bounds to be set and whatnot. So we had to segregate Corey Lane from the rest of those. And it was actually the reason why we were able to do that, because when Carriage Estates 3 came in, which completed the balance of Corey Lane, the CPDC at that time turned the sole responsibility of completing that roadway over to Carriage Estates 3. If they left portion of that under Carriage 2, we wouldn't be able to recommend acceptance of Corey Lane at this time. So Corey Lane was able to stand in by itself.
What parts of Zachary 3 are so affected?
It's all of Zachary and Gregory Lane.
So by accepting Corey, the town will maintain Corey.
The town will maintain Corey.
But they'll go over Zachary Lane, which is not approved to do so.
Which is technically still a private road yet. I mean, that subdivision is one of the next ones we'll be working on to try to complete there. There is not major work, but there is some work to be done. I mean, we can't really accept a roadway without having any stone bounds in. We don't have to install them all, but we could, you know, stall enough so that at least someone can determine, you know, someone can probably determine where their property lines are when a surveyor goes out to develop the geometry of the roadway.
Okay.
Dividence Road was an existing road that was in place when Carriage Hill 2 Estates was and 3 was being built. Mm-hmm. The planning board, the CPDC at that time, required certain improvements to be made on Dividence Road. It was required to put curbing on and sidewalk on one side and repave the road over. That, the road layout had existed. It was only the requirements to make improvements on that. So where the layout itself did not really fall on subdivision control, that's where town council kind of put this one out of the jurisdiction of CPDC, because it was only improvements that were required to make. What was required was done. We have a layout plan that would, and the improvements were, it didn't stop at Zachary, it ended at Emerson. So basically what we're looking at improving is from Franklin up to Emerson.
So that's the piece that we're voting to accept.
That's the portion you're voting to accept.
I thought it was only to Zachary.
No, but it is to Emerson, because they actually had to make some, it's basically to this lot line right here. It's the sideline of Zachary. So from the sideline of the easterly sideline of Zachary to the end of the road into the school's property, that's the portion that will remain private.
Very good.
Pondview Lane is off of Fairchild Drive.
Not to be confused with Pond Meadow Drive.
Right. This one actually came before the came up for approval acceptance about 5 years ago. It actually made it to the board public hearing.
Yep.
And due to some concerns of the residents of a defect in the sidewalk, the selectmen at that time decided not to go through with it. What we found is that the defect in the sidewalk, it's minor, it's two tire tracks. It had nothing to do with the development itself. It was actually, we don't know who, but it was either Verizon or RMLD servicing the underground equipment at the rear of the property line. They drove one of the vehicles on the sidewalk and made two tire depressions in there. So, but because it's similar to this meeting, just before the deadline of try to get everything on the warrant, the selectmen at that time, no action was taken on the warrant article. this roadway is complete. It's been completed. All the lots have been released. I think all the CPDC really had to do was basically declare that it was complete and recommend acceptance.
Can you explain the meaning of the lots being released? That's
well, what happens when you build a subdivision? The developer is required to do one of two things. Complete the roadway 100%, including utilities, roadway, paving, curbing, trees, and all that, prior to being able to sell a lot. Mm-hmm. So what happens in the beginning, once the CPDC approves a subdivision, the final hearing before anything gets constructed, the developer, the town requires the developer to sign a restrictive covenant, basically saying that they're going to complete the subdivision and construct it in accordance with our rules and regulations, and he is not allowed to transfer ownership of any of those properties unless he properly bonds, unless he bonds for the work. Now in Reading, what we do is typically, once they have at least the binder in the roadway, we'll let them post the bond for the remainder of the work, and then we'll release lots for sale. Because up until that point, a developer can't even sell a lot. They can make agreements, but they can't pass papers on
it. So initially, the house lot actually owns the street out to the midline, because it's a private street? Is that how that usually works?
Well, that comes after the fact, once the lots are transferred. In the olden days, most deeds were read that way. A lot of the newer developments, typically, since it's a lot easier to transfer ownership of a roadway from a developer to a city or town after
the fact.
Developer
keeps the road.
The developer retains interest in the road.
I see.
What happens if the deed is silent, then that's what attorneys call prescriptive rights. The owners technically, based on land court decisions, own to the center of the roadway for along their frontage. But in olden days, back in the 40s and 50s, the deeds actually would be drafted right to the center line.
I think even in the 80s when I was on CPDC, that was true.
It happened. It depends on the attorneys.
I wouldn't call the 50s the olden days.
No, well, I was born then, so. I mean, that's older subdivision
Elvis
days.
Elvis, baby. Elvis.
And this one here is basically from Fairchild to the end. And this was another one that CPDC has approved. The last way is Causeway Road. I apologize for the. Before I took this flash drive out of my computer, the files were there.
Fine.
There you go.
Causeway Road. This was a gravel road back in the 20s, 30s, 40s. Back in 1957, when the state took all the property for Route 93, they actually took all of Lowell Street. Up to Bradford Road, and created a layout of established the layout of Causeway from the end of the state's property up to Lowell Street. This portion here, right now, is technically a street, a public way. It was taken by the state, laid out by the state on behalf of the town. The remainder of the roadway was just a layout that was approved by Board of Survey, which was prior to CPDC, planning
the
board,
old Board of Public Works, probably.
You had the Board of Survey would approve a layout, and then after it was built, the Board of Public Works would actually approve the roadway after it was constructed and whatnot. So there was a layout that was approved, and the layout was approved in two sections. The first section went from Wall Street to about where the D is in Causeway Road, and then this last portion is Causeway Road Extension that was built in 60s, I believe, or 50s, I forget exactly the date. However, from the state yard all the way to the cul-de-sac was a private way. We were petitioned by the residents back in 2004, to make improvements in the roadway and to accept the street.
What happened?
No, we did. It came before the selectmen. They had the hearing. They made a recommendation to to accept the roadway as a accepted street, and that we're going to assess betterments for the repair of the road. It went to town meeting, got approved. The town got the funding. We reclaimed the entire roadway, repaved the roadway over, and patched up a few sidewalks, and the residents are being assessed betterments. Following the town meeting vote, as with all these six streets, I believe it's
60 or 90
days. 90 days from the close of the public hearing, this board is actually supposed to vote the taking document, and sign the plan, and that gets recorded, and that's when everything officially becomes ours legally.
Right.
For some reason, that just wasn't done in a timely manner. So this is being placed back on the warrant just so that we can start that final taking process all over.
So town council said it's not sufficient to just sign the order of taking.
Right.
You really should.
That's right. We have to make the recommendation to acceptance as a public way again, and even went one step further. He had the residents sign a petition recommending it happen again.
Okay. Yep. Does that happen?
Yes.
Yep. Yeah. I circulated it.
Yes. Thanks, Dan. So this is just really to clean up some housework that didn't occur in a timely manner, so that we can record the plan and record the taking document, as what will happen with all these once town meeting closes.
Yeah, well, I really want to commend through you, staff, for doing a lot of very unglamorous but necessary auditing work to find out, you know, things about expired bonds and everything else that had to be done here. There's a lot of legal work involved too. So we're finally getting to closure on these six streets. So that's great. Any comments from the board? Questions? Any comments from the public? Yes.
Yes.
Hey, could you introduce yourself,
so you're
please?
Telling me right now,
could you say your name for the record?
Evelyn Livingstone from Causeway Road.
Okay.
That the street hasn't officially been accepted as a public street.
That's up to this point.
5 years ago.
Yeah.
$8,500 later.
Yeah.
I'd like to think it's going to be accepted.
Yeah.
After the pay of that bill. That's all I want to say.
Have you had to incur any out-of-pocket expenses for that street to maintain it? I would not think
not
so.
Not to maintain it.
Yeah. You've been plowed?
Yes, we
okay.
have. Yeah.
We were plowed before because the school bus used to
yes.
go down there.
We plow actually all public and private streets for public safety reasons, at least to a minimum level on the private. But
I mean, we've got sewerage down the street, the whole thing, and we were shocked when we found out that it was still a private road.
But it sounds like from all practical perspectives, it's been treated like a public, but we apologize for that delay, and we're going to make it right for you now. So thank you for signing the petition. Yes.
Can I ask George a question?
You may.
What's going on as far as the two lots as you come into Causeway Road on the left? My understanding is Austin Prep owns that. Is there talk of filling it in and house lots? And what can you bring me up to speed on that?
All I can say is I know that there was talk from Austin Prep to fill those lots in with the surplus fill that they were generating from their track construction. I'm not even sure where they are in the status of that. I know they did run into some roadblocks on that and whatnot, but other than filling it, that was their only intention. They had a bunch of surplus fill from the track project, and it was the most economical place for them to dispose of it.
So they would level the lot so they don't get the slope going down the tracks?
I think the last I heard is that there were some issues because of the grade of the slope with the rare with the MBTA and the railroad. They had to resolve those issues.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Even though it's all on their property, but railroad had some jurisdiction.
Is that the intent of developing the parcels? Or?
We
haven't heard.
There's all residential, correct?
They're all residential. Yes.
Mm. All right. So I guess that's the best we can tell you right now. Yes,
are there any permits that they need to get to dump fill? Even though it's their own land, isn't it? It's a residential, its own residential, is that?
Not really, but they did come in through a DRT, and we did establish some guidelines and whatnot. But for someone to cut trees in a lot, as long as they're not cutting, as long as they're in their own lot, and they're obviously they're not a public tree, and as long as they're not cutting within, disturbing any vegetation within 100 feet of a wetland resource area, someone could clear cut their lot and there's no permits for that, and someone could fill their lot and there's no permits for that. Now, if they process material on their lot, then there's something in the zoning regulations for that. But to cut trees and fill, as long as they're not violating Chapter 131 laws or street scenic tree laws or public shade tree laws, people have the right to do that without any permit.
Okay.
Thank you.
Any further questions from the audience? Yes, sir. Mr.
Stephen Crook, 137 Pleasant Street. I was curious, is Lynn Village Way, which is the cul-de-sac off of Roma, a public way already?
Yes.
And then a second question. On the private ways with street lighting, who pays the street lighting bill?
If there's a street light there,
I think we pay it.
Most likely we've been paying it, unless... typically what happens in a subdivision is once the development goes in, even though they're required to have street lights, the town decides how many street lights are going to go there and where. While there have been some cases that the developer was sent a bill from RMLD, typically once most of the houses are in, the town starts paying for those lights.
Got me thinking about it was the private stretch of Sanborn Lane, which has a couple of lights on it.
That one's in a different category. That would be something I'd actually have to ask RMLD. I really don't know the answer to that one.
Okay. That part was something I was thinking about.
Yeah, Old Sanborn Lane is likely to remain private by wish of the abutters. Is that true?
Yes.
So far,
okay.
We're talking.
Yes,
right from here.
I know a couple.
Nothing here.
Okay. Thanks, George.
Yes, you were around before when that happened.
Oh yeah. Boulders in the road.
Yes, I heard. I actually saw those.
Really? Yeah, they put a boulder at Roma and Sanborn. It wasn't legal.
Okay.
Yeah, I was very well aware of that because this portion of the development. I actually did a lot of the layout for the contractor that installed it.
Oh, Mr. Rivers.
No, I was working for the contractor, okay. The site contractor that was working for Mr. Rivers.
Oh. Remember
so
well.
I actually remember seeing those boulders.
Yes, further questions from anyone on the board or public? Hearing none, it's time to close the hearing. I don't know if you have a motion.
Yes, I do.
Make one up if you don't.
Move that the Board of Selectmen close the hearing on street acceptances.
Second.
Okay, I'll do roll call vote starting with John Halsey. This is to close the hearing on street acceptances. John?
I think he's listening to the TV.
Yeah, we'll give you a second to get back.
That's 7 second delay.
He's there.
Hey, you there, John?
Yes, I'm here.
We'll probably take you last.
I vote yes.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Berman?
Yes.
Mr. Sexton?
Yes.
Mr. Reno says yes.
Mr. Ensminger says yes. It's 5-0 to close the hearing. We have the motion, please.
Move that the Board of Selectmen recommend the acceptance of Causeway Road, Corey Lane, Dividends Road, Pondview, Roma Lane, and Sailor Tom's Way as public streets.
Is that seconded?
Second.
Okay, Mr. Reno seconds. All in favor? Mr. Halsey?
I'm in favor.
Okay, Mr. Berman?
Yes.
Mr. Sexton?
Yes.
Mr. Reno, yes.
Ensminger, yes. The motion carries 5-0, so this will next be taken up by town meeting at the subsequent town meeting in November, and it should be a pretty pro forma issue, I would think. Thank you, everybody. Yes, Phil.
How long after the meeting in November does it actually become public place?
So, George, what's the time frame on signing the order of taking?
Well, I mean, I believe the town council is already working on the document. So I think as soon as town meeting officially closes, depending on the timing of the selectmen's meeting, we have to set up another public hearing in order to do this. So
okay.
I would think sometime in December.
All
Early December.
Probably the 15th.
On the 15th, okay.
Thank you.
Okay, thanks, everybody. Yeah, one final.
Does that mean that the street won't be actually accepted for another few weeks?
Correct. Officially, yeah.
Officially?
Yeah.
But you spent our money already.
Chairman, if I may, we spent the money to make the improvements in the roadway that have been done. That's all that was for, was to pay for the asphalt and to make the improvements and the drainage we put in at the end of the roadway. We've been treating it as if it's a public way ever since we did that.
That was kind of my comment earlier.
Well, we appreciate it. It's a lot better than going through those big puddles.
That's for sure.
Thanks for your patience.
Yeah.
Okay. Anybody need to take a break, or should we just push on here?
Going.
Let's talk about the warrants for the November town meeting. In your packet, you have the town council approved version. Starting on page, there's a summary on 14, and the warrant actually starts on page 17. So, Bob, could you walk us through the articles, please?
Certainly. Starting on page 19, the first three articles we see at every town meeting by charter, same language, except the dates sometimes change. The fourth article, we do have two prior year bills, which take a 9/10 vote. One was on purpose. We didn't have enough funds in June to pay a high school litigation bill. And the other was just discovered a month or so ago. It was a 3 or 4 year old plumbing bill from facilities in the schools.
What's the magnitude of these bills?
That's a small one. The legal bill is around $40,000 for the month of June. Okay. So we just didn't have sufficient funds to pay it in June.
Okay. All right.
Those are the only two prior year bills I'm aware of. And again, that's a 9/10 vote. Article 5 is the typical, if you will, the standard FY16 budget amendments, which we'll discuss tomorrow night at great length.
I think we've been presented some detail on this already. But I got a little more detail tonight.
Okay. And actually, there's one more piece that is not in tonight. We had a generator problem at the fire station. So that may find its way in front of town meeting. Article 6 is what you just covered, and you know the vote at town meeting will be more specific as to the location, which was described by.
I just noticed an error there.
Which one?
Dividends Road. It's not to the dead end. It's to Emerson.
Yeah, that's correct.
Is it Emerson Street? It's
Emerson Street.
It's spelled.
It has to be amended.
Okay, well we can do that.
Is it street or avenue?
Street.
It's road.
No, Emerson Street, where to the...
So the last item there should read, and it is dividends is misspelled, it should be D-I-V-I. Dividends rose from Franklin Street to Emerson Street instead of to Dead End.
Dead End is all the way...
It's Emerson to Dead End, it's not being accepted.
Okay.
Anybody notice any other issues there?
Good eyes, Dan.
Let me just keep looking to make sure Zachary has traveled to Dead End.
Yeah, we got to do it now because we're closing it.
Zachary to Dead End.
Do we need a motion to change that?
You'll vote on the final product.
Okay, thanks.
Good catch.
Is Causeway from Lowell to the Dead End?
Isn't part of it already accepted,
isn't it?
I guess, would this take it as a town property from the state?
I think it's fine. Okay. There's already a portion that's public. There's no harm in doing it again.
Okay.
But the state owns it.
Right.
It's public. They take it over to us, correct?
We're taking it from the state, I guess.
I think it's a public way.
It's a public way.
Okay.
Yeah. There's no harm in that.
Okay.
The next few articles are from CPDC. Mm-hmm. You can see Article 7 is the purpose, the one that came a year or so ago to town, a special town meeting.
Yeah, table of contents.
Yeah.
It's fairly straightforward. Article 8 is certainly, to me, very complex. It's a personal wire service facility. It's a very complex bylaw that the town council is going to have to explain quite in detail. I know CPDC spent a lot of time on this, but there really was not any kind of controversy in all their discussions and hearings that I'm aware of.
Is this language largely dictated by FCC or not?
No, I don't think so. This is as chosen by town council working with CPDC.
All right. They will present
some of the terms were dictated, such as that personal wireless device.
Yeah. Bob, will Ray be making this presentation?
I believe that the first three zoning articles, the presentation will be made by the chair of CPDC, and certainly town council will be right there. And I think Gene will probably sit at the computer like we did a year ago and, you know, do all the visuals.
Right. I think that's very good optics, by the way, having town council sit up
yeah.
front.
Okay.
I think it's excellent.
My only recommendation, just in preparing the presentation, it's a complicated piece.
Yeah.
Yes.
I just think if there could be a half a page kind of thing about what it's trying to accomplish, why we need it, what it's changed, you know, just something
what's
that,
going on, that's
as
different.
Opposed to trying to words, you know, what happens when we do zoning at town meeting, you know, there's a lot of wordsmithing going around, and that's partly because people sometimes don't understand what the intention
you
is.
You want to give like an essence of the article.
A 30,000 foot view of.
Yeah. Right. Why we need it, what it's accomplishing, what happens if we don't do it, you know, all those kinds of things. And then.
Zoning so even the town manager could understand.
Well,
how you put it.
Yeah.
Yeah, I agree.
And that would be, I guess, the same one, same record for any additional zoning piece. I know the introductory piece, I mean, we went through last year.
Right.
But again, the same kind of thing, just to kind of, so people can understand.
One question on Article 8 is Section B. So it's 5631B2.
Yep.
Just make sure I found.
Bottom of page 22. Mm-hmm. 3. A new PWSF installation, and that's personal wireless service facility for those of you at home.
Where are you, John?
I'm on the bottom of page 22, number 3. A new PWSF installation is the third preference of any existing structure to the extent that it's found by the CPDC. So that's any town structure? Any town building, for example? Or is that the structure defined elsewhere? I didn't see it.
It's defined in zoning, but otherwise not. So it wouldn't be unique to this.
So it could be a building,
for
example.
It could be any structure.
Okay.
Public, private.
Mm-hmm. All right. I could imagine that gets a little attention because it's different from an antenna or a tower built for a purpose.
Yeah, the antenna is the next one. Mm-hmm. Right. New antenna tower.
All right. That's it.
Okay. Follows is a far less complex, but I'm sure it'll be an interesting discussion about the aquifer protection district. Again, my understanding of the meetings that CPDC had there was little to no controversy about this.
Can a clean version of this be made available when we publish the warrant report or electronically or somehow?
When you say a clean version, you mean
without the strikeouts?
Oh, sure. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, that's
as proposed.
That's pretty. I understand why they did that, but
yeah,
probably should include both.
To Barry's earlier point, I think this is another one where a brief overview of the intent of the changes would be helpful to kind of overcome any anxiety that people might naturally have.
Is your preference to have a clean version in the town meeting warrant report as part of the background, or to have a separate handout?
I think that would probably be sufficient, yeah.
I like it in one place if we can have it that way.
I mean, it'd be nice to have it in the warrant what the new one is.
Yeah.
But I think what tried to happen last time was that people can have, here's the old one, here's the new one, so they can visually see what the changes were. I mean, at some point it needs to all be in one. The new one needs to be printed without the lines. But maybe if you go section by section and say this is the change, you know, sometimes it's just clearing up a, you know, numeration. Other time it's more substantive.
There's a lot of deleted material in this one, so
it's
going to be hard to correlate.
In some cases, the thing we learned a year ago, my preference is to see the old and the new, bold and cross out.
Yeah.
But when you're just moving something from place A to place B, it looks like it's crossed out and then it's all bold.
Sometimes
but maybe nothing changed.
Nothing might have changed,
so.
Yeah.
Well, maybe just a list of them. These are the changes.
Then that changed.
The translation guide that Jesse did a year ago.
Right.
That was an excellent idea.
Yeah.
And then, you know, you're not just dealing with, like, we're now numbering a 10.2 instead of 10.3, but this is the change that it's going to do. Then people can debate the merits of, you know, whether that's a good idea or a bad idea, and then the words will follow.
Okay. That's good to know. Let's see. Yeah. This was Article 10 was discussed last night by CPDC, and they agreed it was a good idea. Just to back up a little, as part of the Charter Committee, which I know Steve remembers, we discussed associate members, and what was decided on the floor at town meeting is that a bylaw is a better place to set the rules for associate members once the Charter allows it. So sure enough, the Charter was passed in January. In April town meeting, we passed the general bylaw. It turns out the Attorney General thought that both CPDC and ZBA should not be covered by a general bylaw. It should be a zoning bylaw, which one of these surprised Ray and one did not. The default and the preference, the way we wrote the general bylaw, would be to have two associate members for CPDC. But there's you know, a reason that the state gave why one is the limit. And we explained that to CPDC last night, and they understand. Mm-hmm. And the two-year term is, you know, it's kind of the standard associate term.
Right.
For ZBA, they can have two members, and they need to have a three-year term.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the only difference. Otherwise, the intent of both of these was to mirror what we would have done as a general bylaw, just have a zoning bylaw. But again, the changes are only one associate member for CPDC. ZBA can have two. And then two-year terms for CPDC, but three-year terms for ZBA.
And is that the state that...
Yep.
Recommended that? Is there a rationale, or does it pay to even ask?
There is a rationale. I couldn't repeat it right now, but I think it also had to do with the way we had set up the Charter.
I think there's statutory requirements in 40A that cover it.
Right.
And we didn't quite track those the way we needed to.
Right.
Is the minimum term length mirrored for other associate member tenures?
There's a list of all other ones are 2 years.
Okay.
So these are the only ones that would be different. Well, the 3 years the only one that's different. And then there was an understanding that as the selectmen first rolled it out, you might do a 1 year and a 2 year, and then it would be 2 years after that just to get a cycle set up. If there were two associate members on a board,
just to get odd,
you might do a 1 year and a 2 year to get
right.
yourself started. And then after that, it'd be 2 years.
Right.
Article 11 was at my suggestion just to follow up on some work done by the Charter Committee. The Charter has extensive language for removal now, and so this bylaw just cleans up by crossing out that sentence there and replacing it with, go look at the Charter. The Charter now spells out how, you know, and what the removal process is, so this is fairly simple.
That's not the only criterion for removal.
That's correct. Yeah, okay. The Charter lists several, actually, whatever a board or you may wish.
Okay.
It doesn't have to be a reason. It seemed reasonable to leave this in,
mm-hmm.
And then just point to the right location.
And can we just maybe, again, to have that language in the Charter referenced
sure.
in the background
yeah.
so that people
yep.
can say, okay, this is, so
yeah,
you don't
absolutely.
Have to go hunt for the Charter.
Yep.
That's a good
right,
idea.
Yeah. Now we get to a couple of bylaws that Dan and I have talked about. Article 12 is to remove the residency requirement entirely and renumber subsequent bylaws. And just to give you a little background again from the Charter discussion, I would say the Charter Review Committee was generally in favor of not limiting attendance or participation, and in any sense did not want the Charter to limit it. So
right.
if there was to be any kind of a limit or allowance, again, it would be spelled out by a general bylaw. So the way this article is drafted would strike any limit, and there would be no residency requirement for any member of the board. And my only comment of that, you know, what the right answer is, I don't know, but there have been specific instances in the past where having a non-resident was helpful.
Right.
So I can think of when we had an ad hoc tax classification committee, the business community had to be represented by a Reading resident that happened to be a business owner. It's not necessarily easy to find.
Hmm. I too would not want to see an outright prohibition. However, I think removing all restrictions seems unduly general, and I think the context of the discussion the board had in the past was that we were thinking in terms of out of town. People had a business in Reading but lived out of town. There might be a situation where their expertise or their balance would be needed on a board, maybe a future EDC or something like that.
Or they own property.
Or they own property.
And live out of town.
But I could live out.
I could see property ownership as, yeah, or citizenship as the primary. And right, to my sense, this should permit the occasional inclusion of, but not allow the entitlement of a general right to.
Right.
So it's a little bit broader than I'd recall the discussion
yeah.
being.
Yeah,
me too.
Yeah, me too.
So the thought is we pull this back and work it into a more.
Yeah, we can do a comeback in April.
Yeah.
Because there's nothing driving this.
No.
So it's just, yeah.
No, other than just the charter discussion, and this is
right,
sort of a natural follow-up. But
to that
no
end,
time
though,
limit or
sorry.
Yeah, okay. Mm-hmm.
To that end, is it possible to, I think the board's all in agreement that obviously beyond citizens, those individuals that own property but don't reside here but pay taxes on that property would be logical parties to include under this kind of an extension.
I think there'd be a lot of logical parties that you could you could include. You'd have to be careful about, you know, having
you.
It's tough because you got to be careful about having just specific ones
the question
as well
is,
as
yeah,
not having broad.
You're answering,
you know,
my question.
Where's that middle ground?
Should we enumerate them or should we simply leave it at on a discretionary basis?
I would enumerate what we can, and maybe there's a combination of general and discrete, but I think there should be a restriction in some sense on the degree, the percent of the board that we comprise this way.
Then the second question
yeah,
is, for those cases that are so identified, would you
yeah,
put a, the wider you make this, the more potential you have for unintended mischief, right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And would you put an additional qualifier for out-of-town attendees in that, obviously they go through the VASC, right?
Right. Yeah.
But would you also say they, and they're already, I presume, have the support of the board and they're wishing to join, but you don't always have that.
It's not always the case.
Some people
right,
want to
yeah,
join without
so
going through the committee.
Right,
so
you're into it. Would you put other constraints but requirements on their participation?
I just also point out that more than the Board of Selectmen can form committees now, so
yeah,
it's not just your committees that this would apply to.
Although others have not chosen.
That's,
yeah,
that's
correct,
a good point.
Hmm. So maybe we need some
further discussion,
additional dialogue,
yeah,
I think
yes,
I think excellent points have been made here.
And we want to allow it
yeah,
where it makes
I think
sense.
Selectively,
that,
right.
Right. I think we all agree on that.
But we just
have
to be careful
how we
frame
it.
And each time
that,
it'll
yeah,
come up and say, well, does that one make sense? And
yeah.
But there's the selectivity and then there's the approval right, process, Barry. It's both. It's when do you do it and how do you approve the candidate? Because it's an odd
right,
every one of them is going
right,
to be
right,
odd.
I mean, it could be a former Reading resident that just loves the town and wants to, you know,
yeah,
be, it could be so many different things.
It could
yeah,
be specific expertise, it could be the business
right,
component, it could be property.
Let's
component.
Keep going.
Yeah, there, I mean, there always could be, like
the restriction.
Bob was saying, where it does go out to where other committees can now, you know, form these as well, that if you make it something extraordinary, would have to go before the VASC, regardless of
right,
that committee. But I don't
it,
know if that's changing the charter now.
You could have five CPDC members from all the towns on. But you couldn't.
Well, don't laugh if you
yeah,
if it's
you
not
right,
prohibited.
Not
you
done,
could
right,
have
yeah, prohibited. You could
yeah,
yeah.
We don't have enough interest in writing.
You get some,
Yes, sir, Mr. Brown.
Constitutionality of it. I think you better check that one first.
What do you mean?
In what regard?
Representation.
Representation. You're getting somebody from outside representing running residents. Question whether.
That's why the tax discussion is useful.
Yeah.
Next question. And you say outside residents, how about the guys that own Home Depot? Do they get a vote? They're taxpayers.
Well, things we'll have to wrestle with, but we'll take that under advisement.
Yeah,
yeah.
And the Constitution, you have to.
Yeah, it seems smart that Ray would be involved in this
yeah,
discussion.
Well, he said this bylaw, this change is fine. You can do what he suggested.
Well, it's fine,
if you
but
wish
it doesn't reflect what the board is discussing.
No, that
yeah,
could
yeah,
be, but
right,
it's constant.
So the barn door approach is legal, but not in my mind preferable.
Not, and I don't want to take something that brought a town meeting. So is there a sense of the board to defer on 12?
Yes.
Yes.
So that
please,
will be removed from the warrant. Very good.
Speaking of the barn door,
yes.
The next one is animal control.
Some animals are more equal.
Not animal house, animal control.
A significant set of changes have happened to state law to require basically every municipality to redo their animal control bylaw.
This one's tough.
So this one's from Ray, and it's the first I've seen of it today, and I suggested to Dan we also just defer this to April. I think you want to have town council in here and have the public in here at least once and maybe for two meetings over the winter.
It seems very
I don't think there's anything controversial here, but where it's just so new, I think it's the wiser course. There's no, again, there's no hurry for this one.
Right.
Ray has been working very closely with the AG's office because, again, everyone needs to do this. And he thinks he has a really good bylaw, but I talked to him today and he said there's no hurry. The AG is not, you know, pushing this to be in a hurry. It'd be good if we did it, you know, as soon as we are comfortable doing it. But I think my preference, and certainly Dan agreed, is let's get the public involved if they wish to be.
Yeah.
Well, no, I mean, if you just go back to town meetings in the past, the things that generate the most amount of oxygen are things dealing with animals.
That's true.
Birds, bees, dogs, you know.
Chickens.
Chickens and bees.
Birds and bees.
The one part of this that I think will eventually be a problem is 88323, which is the exception for assistance animals, in that the definition of what a properly trained assistance animal is left, and I don't know if you've had encountered it, but I've had people bring a dog in and it's described as a comfort animal or my best friend, or it's a mental health kind of a thing. And I'm not dismissing any of those purposes, don't get me wrong, but this would seem to allow almost any and all potential uses, but we'll leave that for a future board maybe.
Do they certify those animals? They get a piece.
But it's properly trained, so do you come in with a certificate?
The ones that are trained do get the.
They do, and they have a coat that they wear or a vest, and it's got a badge or something, but.
But they don't have to be certified or trained to fall into this category.
Exactly.
Yeah, my sister-in-law is training one. If he flunks, they get to keep the dog, so they're trying to convince him to fail his tests.
Anyway, that's an area I think is going to have to need more attention.
We have an animal control officer here now.
We have an appeals committee of 3 members.
That's right.
So we're functional, but we need to improve the bylaw.
We used to be the appeal board. I think they got pushed off. Thank God.
And another point to be brought forward here is we are working with some other towns to regionalize animal control, and we've talked about having a standard bylaw. So it's not a bad idea to push this off to April to allow that discussion to play out. So we will definitely know by April what's going to happen.
Should we push that through to the local veterinary and the local animal boarding and that
sort of? We actually have a veterinarian that's on the Board of Health that's very interested in this. She's highly involved, so yeah.
But through the community of, you know, boarding houses and grooming houses and the various animal health care practitioners, is there a way to push this through just to get the word out faster?
Yes, and actually sometime during December, maybe January, the town clerk would like to come in and have a discussion on fines for dog licenses. So it's related. It's not the same, but it's related. It's a similar audience.
And for not having a license?
You know, there's fines. There's one set by town meeting. I don't think we want to change that, but we have $5 a month, forever.
Yeah, is it worth the effort?
And it's really not worth the aggravation or the effort. And we now can offer a multi-year dog license if people want to afford themselves for that. The technology is there, so. Just a discussion to have. Maybe we want to tie it into a discussion of this just because there's related people that would be interested.
Get a sticker for your car, a sticker for your dog.
The next article you've recognized from executive session, this is to authorize a settlement of litigation that has come and been tabled twice to town meeting. I believe we actually have a deal now. But
14, 15, 16 are now 12, 13, and 14.
Correct. Article 15 in here, which will be renumbered, was the article that the cemetery trustees brought forward last Thursday.
Yep.
I discussed it briefly with Bill earlier. It's captured all their intentions. And the very last article is the firearms bylaw that I know a couple of selectmen have worked on. So we'll have 14 articles at November town meeting. It'll likely be 2 nights. It's possible it's 3 if something slows us down. The finance we're doing is a little complex, and we'll also need that 20,000 foot explanation just to simplify it. So that's it.
Good. Okay, so we have a motion for 14 articles. Yep. Sorry, John Halsey, do you have any comments before we close the board?
Yeah, he's there. John, are you there?
It's okay if you don't.
Well, I've been listening right along. I'm kind of jockeying the sound system here so I don't blow your meeting.
I understand.
But I have nothing else to add. I think that makes sense to remove those two. And,
okay.
The other 14 seem to need to go forward.
Thank you, sir. Appreciate it.
Okay. Motion?
Move that the Board of Selectmen close the warrant consisting of 14 articles for the 2015 subsequent town meeting to take place on November 9, 2015 at 7:30 p.m. in the Performing Arts Center, 62 Oakland Road.
Yes. I'll second the motion.
Okay. Okay, we'll poll the board. Mr. Halsey, closing the warrant. Okay. Mr. Berman?
Yes.
Mr. Sexton?
Yes.
Mr. Arena votes yes.
Mr. Ensminger votes yes. 5-0. Motion carries. The warrant is closed for the subsequent town meeting. Thank the board. Is there any other business to come before us tonight? If not, I will entertain a motion.
I'd like to make a motion to adjourn.
Mr. Arena moves to adjourn. Is that
second?
Seconded by Mr. Berman. We'll poll the board. Mr. Halsey to adjourn. Yes, sir.
You're voting to hang up.
You can hang up after your vote.
No. We're adjourning to adjourn.
Okay. I vote yes.
Okay, thank you. Yes, sir, Mr. Berman?
Yes.
Mr. Arena votes yes.
Yes. 5 yeses, we are adjourned. Thank you, John.
Send the warrant.
Take care.
Thanks, John.
Yep.